How many books do you know of that address topics of education and welfare, local government, state government, taxation, money and banking, free markets, courts, war and the military, and the executive power? How many books do you know actually talk about these topics from a biblical perspective and set forth all of the issues, ideas, the history, and the hurdles, and the blueprints for the way forward? Hi, I'm Joel McDermott with AmericanVision.org. In Restoring America One County at a Time, I cover all these topics and more, showing you how America was once free, how those freedoms were lost, and giving you an uncompromising biblical approach to get those freedoms back. I focus on practical steps, local solutions, personal sacrifices, and it has a multi-generational vision. So don't just sit around talking about Restoring America. Actually do something. And you can start by getting my book, Restoring America One County at a Time, at AmericanVision.org.
I would say if the authorities didn't want us involved in the public square, they ought not to have crucified Jesus in the public square.
Use humanistic principles.
Well, I would say
the same idea.
I would say
same
end. I would say, what's the problem with stardust bumping into stardust?
In the cosmic picture, none. There's no problem. In the cosmic picture, it won't matter.
No, Mr. President, you are not protecting reproductive freedom. You are authorizing the destruction of freedom for 1 million little human beings every year.
I'm sorry, my friends, but I am tired of seeing Jesus presented as a weak beggar. He is a powerful Savior, and the gospel is not a suggestion, it is a command.
Reverend Mola, don't you sympathize with that?
I sympathize with every single human heart wishing to know the one true and living God, but I believe there's only one way that that can happen, through Jesus Christ, and the gospel is about repenting of sin, not celebrating it.
Right now, you're on the threshold of an amazing adventure. We will explore the spiritual abyss. You have not experienced this before. You're gonna love it.
What's up, y'all? This is Apologia Radio. Right here, coming at you from Phoenix, Arizona. Jeff Durbin, one of your hosts here, Apologia Radio, with the local bear. The local bear. Luke the Bear Pearson.
What is up?
What's up, y'all? Hey, welcome to the show today. Excited to have this broadcast with someone that I love, someone that I think is a treasure and a gift to the church today. His name is Sye Ten Bruggencate. I'm going to introduce you to him in a moment. Actually, I think, Luke, I was thinking this morning, I think this is actually the fourth show that we've had Sye on
with us.
Yeah, it's like four times now. We had him once on with Dustin Seegers, which was really great. That was like
way back when. Had him on with Dustin.
And we had another time we did a show about when Christopher Hitchens died.
Yeah.
We did another show with Dan Barker.
Yep.
And then now this is this one. But this one's really, and for me, really exciting because we're going to have a full 2 hours of the broadcast, essentially, giving us an opportunity for instruction. We are hoping to have an atheist in studio to discuss the issues with us on the air with Sye and Luke and I. I'm excited. Now, if you don't know who Sye Ten Bruggencate is, he's one of my faves. I found out about Sye a long time ago through the Unbelievable radio program. I heard him on there. That's Justin Brierley's program over there in London, right? That's where he's at, right?
Yeah.
London, yeah.
Yeah.
And so Sye was on arguing for the presuppositional defense of the faith. And I immediately was like, wow, I really like this guy. We're right in line theologically. And so I'm really excited. And one thing is that atheists don't usually like Sye, do they, Luke?
No.
Usually, this is sort of like what happens when an atheist engages Sye. I'm just going to play a little clip here. This is actually an audio recording, Luke.
Okay.
A secret audio recording from somebody that just finished speaking with Sye.
Okay.
Shut up! Cut it out! You're crazy. That's what I think. You're screwing. You're driving me crazy too. I'm seeing things here. I'm going home and see my wife and family. You understand that? And I'm going home alone.
It's funny. I have a clip of Sye too.
That, you do?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's see. Yeah, let's get it.
Here it is.
I don't know why you always have to be judging me. Because I only believe in science.
All right, Sye. We'll go ahead and pull you on now, man. How you doing, brother?
Great. Great to be here. Thanks for having me on.
Dude, I love you, man. So I'm so excited to have you on again. This is four times for us. And this one, again, I'm really excited about in this one because we have something very exciting to introduce. And you just finished a production with Crown Rights Media. And it was for American Vision. Am I correct about that?
That's correct. Yeah. I went to visit that ministry last year sometime. And they really enjoyed how the presuppositional approach was brought to the street level, and they were interested in putting together a project. And I was just down in Georgia. We finished filming that. It's still in the editing process, but we've released some promotional information for that. So.
Well, this is really important, Sye. You just touched on something that I think is very, very critical, and that is that the presuppositional apologetic is the biblical apologetic. That's what we want to refer to it as, the biblical approach to engaging the world with the gospel, where we don't separate apologetics from our proclamation of the gospel. You, like me, have been heavily influenced by men of God like Greg Bonson and Van Til and things like that. And so what you've done, I think, is effectively brought what are some sometimes hard to grasp concepts from Bonson when he talks about epistemology, how do we know what we know, and talking about the biblical foundations of that. You have taken it to the street level. You're bringing it into the culture. You're engaging some top atheists. So just talk about your experience with that.
Well, I grew up in a Christian home, and I always had a passion for defending my faith, but then I discovered that most of my life I was doing it wrong. And I think I've always had the gift of taking the difficult arguments and dumbing them down to my level. And that's what I would do with these different arguments and the ontological, the theological, the cosmological. And I would share them with my Christian friends, and they loved them. And then I would take these arguments out into the world, and I'd get them thrown back in my face. And I had to do a long think over that. I thought, well, why do Christians love these arguments and unbelievers don't like them? And it was simple. Christians love these arguments because they're Christians.
Mm.
And unbelievers don't like them because they're not Christians.
Right.
And then it wasn't until I heard the Bonson-Stein debate, Greg Bonson versus Gordon Stein, and that was my introduction into this biblical apologetic. And I didn't even actually know what I was hearing when I heard it the first time.
Yeah, me too. Me too.
But I still get something out of that every time I listen to it. But I realized that when I was defending my faith, I wasn't even talking about the God I believe in.
Yeah.
I was talking about a figment of the world's imagination, a probable God that the world wants us to represent, not the certain God that we talk about in church. Because what I say in my talks, I say in church, we say, nothing can separate me from the love of the Father. Tears streaming down our faces. I mean, what a beautiful, comforting verse. Nothing can separate me from the love of the Father. And then the very next day, we go out into the world and we say, well, I could be wrong.
Yeah.
But the problem is, if you could be wrong, you can't say nothing can separate me from the love of the Father. So we're talking about some probability out in the world instead of the certainty that we proclaim in church. So what this apologetic does, it takes the Lord of our theology and makes him the Lord of our apologetic too. And I say this is not just a cool way to argue, it's life-changing. And yeah. I've had emails from people that were afraid to go onto YouTube and watch certain atheistic YouTube videos because they were afraid it would shake their faith.
Mm.
And now when they understand this biblical apologetic, they go and watch these videos and they end up laughing at the folly of atheism. I think, I don't know what happens to a person when they go from being afraid, you know, and talking about a probabilistic God to representing their faith in a certain God. I don't think that that's the point that they become saved, but I sure love when it happens.
Yeah. You know, Sye, this is probably something that everyone who's listening to you maybe for the first time, or they're really now engaging this issue of, well, I mean, there's a way to actually do this biblically. What do we usually say to them, Sye, when we talk to them about like the reason, the moral requirements of doing apologetics correctly? Like, it's actually a moral issue of doing this correctly. Because, and I'll give you what I would say as a start to somebody. I want to say that, you know, Jesus says you can't serve two masters. You're going to love the one, or, you know, and he talks about you're either for him or against him. So there's no middle ground with Jesus, no neutrality. You're for him or against him. And the fact that Peter talks about always be ready with a reason defense, but he doesn't say that until he first says to first set apart Christ as Lord in your hearts. So talk about that for a second, the necessity to approach this issue with a commitment first to Christ as Lord, and why that would be important.
Yeah, that's right. When somebody denies the existence of God, what we end up doing is we believe them, and we approach them on a neutral ground. We set God on the shelf, and we say, well, let's examine the evidence to see which worldview makes most sense to try and conclude that God exists. Mm. But that would I actually say that's a sinful approach.
Yes.
Because what we're actually doing there is we're giving the unbeliever evidence for the existence of God. And the question I ask, I say, where do you hear evidence out in the world? Most often you hear it in the court of law. And I say, who do you give evidence to in court? You give it to the judge and the jury. So when the unbeliever comes up to you and says, I don't believe in God, and we give them evidence, we're saying that they're the judge and the jury.
Hmm.
And who's on trial? God.
God's on trial, yeah.
And the thing is, I'm not against evidence. People always confuse this. They say I'm against evidence. Not at all. Evidences are a wonderful gift from God. They're so wonderful, in fact, that we can win that court case.
Mm-hmm.
We can acquit God, but the problem is the unbeliever is still the judge.
Right.
Now, that's not to say that God has not used evidences to bring people to a saving faith in Jesus Christ. You know, he can strike a straight blow with a bent stick. I think it was Van Til that said this.
Mm.
But that does not mean that we should use bent sticks. So rather than take a neutral approach, we have to sanctify Christ as Lord in our hearts. We have to start with him. Because what I say is God is not a God that we can reason to. He's the God that we can't reason without.
Okay.
It says in Romans 11:36, from him, through him, and to him are all things. All things would include my reasoning and the reasoning of the unbeliever. So we have to start with God.
So the person says to you, Sy, I mean, obviously we want to equip Christians on this show. We also want to engage the unbelieving community as well. But they're listening to you now, and they're like, okay, start with God. He's the foundation. What would, and we're going to play a clip from your video here in just a few minutes, but what would that look like, though? What are you telling them they need to look for as they are engaging this issue of apologetics and evangelism? What are they supposed to be looking for as they talk to the person? Because you're saying start with God,
right,
and not reason to God. Like, let's look,
right,
let's look at the cosmological, the teleological. Let's see if we look at cause and effect relationships, the irreducible complexity of life, da-da-da-da-da-da-da. And you start saying, you're saying, no, you start firmly with your feet planted in what God says about himself and what's who he is. So what do they look for when they talk to somebody?
Well, the thing is, we all get the same evidence, but we interpret the evidence according to what we already believe. We interpret the evidence according to the beliefs we take to the evidence, our pre-beliefs, our presuppositions. So I don't examine the evidences. I examine the beliefs that we take to the evidence. And I say, now, what is necessary to examine evidence? You need knowledge. You need truth.
Yes.
You need logic.
Yep.
And what I say is that you cannot make sense of even one of those unless you start with God.
Mm.
But I find that the easiest one to explain to Christians and unbelievers alike is knowledge. Because in Proverbs 1:7 it says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. In Colossians 2:2-3, in Christ are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Now, I take that as my presupposition. That being the case, if you deny God, if you deny Christ, it follows that you cannot justify anything you claim to know.
Mm.
So when I go up to an unbeliever, I say, look, the Bible says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. You have to start with God to know anything at all. Now, since you deny him, Mr. Unbeliever, how can you know anything?
Mm-hmm.
And then when they give their knowledge claims, I dismantle it. But sadly, very often, they deny knowledge right off the bat, and they concede the argument.
Yeah.
And people will argue for hours and hours and hours with an unbeliever about evidence, and they love it because you're making them the judge.
You know what's amazing, Sy? Can I say this real fast? This is what's so important, is that, Sy, when they watch your – we're going to play the clip here next segment, but when they watch this, they're going to say – so there's no point talking past that point. You've already destroyed. He says he can't even know anything. And that's just the point, right, Sy? Is that now you can call him to repentance. Is now you can say, now you've exposed the complete folly of your worldview. Now you need to turn from sin to this God, the true and living God, to Christ, where there is freedom and forgiveness, where he saves not only your soul, but also your reasoning. We'll be right back with Sy Ten Bruggencate talking about the new video with American Vision, How to Answer a Fool. We'll be right back.
Right back.
This is my ode to the atheistic worldview. Ready? Here it comes. Ready? I'm saying that playfully, though, right? I'm just being playful.
Don't be so mean.
I know. Now, you know why I brought that up. Here's why I brought it up. It's on purpose, okay? I'm not just being nasty. It's on purpose. While I was looking up videos the other day to maybe play some clips with Sye, I saw an atheist with this little clip like responding to Sye Ten Bruggencate. You know, he's a dummy. He's ridiculous. And refuting Sye Ten Bruggencate in 10 seconds kind of a thing. And he does the whole thing. And there's nothing. And absolutely nothing. Except at the end of the clip, this is how he finishes the clip. That's why I played that. And this is how he finishes the clip in response to Sye. He says, all right, this is Bobo, whatever his name was. I'll call him Bobo for now. This is Bobo, and I'm out. I'll get back later with you guys. And so this is me telling you, just stay alive. Don't die.
Well, at least he's being honest.
Don't die. That was the let me finish my thing. Don't die. Because it's basically it, right?
Yeah.
I mean, just don't die. That's the position they're coming from. So, Sye, welcome back on the air, man.
Thanks for having me back.
Yeah, man. So
that's what I tell them, too. Stay alive as long as you can, because this is the best it's going to get for you.
You know what's funny, Sye, is that people will say that to me, because you and I, we engage us the same way. And so, biblically, I'm saying, like with God as our foundation, and people will say that to me. I'll say, well, listen, you've got better things to be doing right now. Try bowling. Try skydiving. Do something.
Right.
Stay
but
alive.
I also tell them that the time of their death is not in their hands.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. And to expose that, when you talk about starting with God, we're talking about that. Where those kinds of discussions, we're saying, well, look at your feet. You know, you're bipedal meat bone protoplasm. You're bobbing on the surface of the cosmos, and there is no good. There's no evil. You're going to live, and you're going to die, and then you're gone. So, like, listen, don't die. I mean, you've got better things to be doing than arguing with me right now. If you're consistent with your own position, is just try to stay alive. Don't you have something more exciting to be doing right now with the little time you've got here? Hmm. I mean, what does protoplasm do with the time that it's got? Does it sit and engage with another bag of protoplasm? And that's what we're talking about by engaging their position is talking about making them look at their feet. Now, I know that, Sye, you and I have both learned a lot from, say, someone like Douglas Wilson in regards to this apologetic and some interesting ways to put this. But one thing I like that Douglas Wilson says about what we're talking about is he says it's important to not just listen to what's coming out of their mouths and by way of what's coming out of their heads, their argument, the noises they're making, but to look down at their feet as to what they're standing on. And that's something that you're constantly doing when you approach this issue of apologetics. So, Sye, I'm going to go ahead on the air now and just play the clip, the promo video. This show is brought to you by the American Vision. You can get to them at AmericanVision.org and AmericanVision.com. That's their site for all their bookstore and MP3 downloads, all the stuff they have going on there. But this documentary is phenomenal. It comes out when? Like May 1st or 2nd or 3rd, Sye?
May 3rd is the scheduled release date. I think that they want to have the digital version available a few weeks before that.
Okay, perfect. So this is coming out really, really soon. And the promo video dropped on April 1st, which is April Fool's Day. And the name of the video is How to Answer the Fool. And you might think, well, like what is like fool? Like that's rude.
Yeah.
Like, you know, but what do we mean, Luke, the kind of fool that like it's is it a nasty kind of thing, Luke? Is that what we're doing? Is it like what? Is it like this? Go ahead and play that clip.
It's loading.
Is it loading? Okay. Oh, we have this. We're all ready to go on this. So when we say the Bible says the fool says in his heart there is no God, the Bible's not engaging in the kind of fool,
right?
As in you fool,
yeah,
right? Like the Mr. T kind of fool, like
pity the fool,
pity the fool,
yeah.
Like the arrogant kind of rude, nasty, crass fool.
Now you tell me,
yeah. Not like that, right?
Well, you know, while I'm waiting for this to load, I was gonna say, Sye, we actually had a comment. We posted the promo video on Facebook, and we actually had someone make a comment in regards to this. And I was just gonna read it so you could hear it, and maybe if you could talk about it real quick. This one girl's response was, calling those who are non-believers fools is a terrible idea. You can catch more flies with honey than with vinegar, you know?
Yeah, well, then she should look in her Bible, maybe.
Mm.
Well, you know, it's funny because then I posted for 1 Corinthians 18, or 1:18 through 23, and her response was, yeah, I know.
But she has a valid point, though. It's not like we go around calling them fools.
Right.
It's that we treat their argumentation for the folly that it is. You don't knock on the door and do the Mr. T. But, you know, you approach them lovingly, of course. And like I said, she's right. We don't go around calling them fools.
Right.
And I understand that this title might be offensive to people, but it's a biblical argument. And, you know, I'll let you guys explain the type of fool that we're actually talking about.
Yeah. Luke, we're not saying what?
We're not saying this.
You better watch out, you fool. Yay, fool. Hey, fool!
That's not what we're saying.
Not like that. Yeah. We're saying fool in the sense that the Bible's describing the mindset of a person who refuses to accept what's obvious to everybody. It's really an indictment on a person who's maintaining a position not because of evidence or intellectual firepower, something vocab says, but they're doing it. It's a moral issue, and also it leads to futility in thinking. That's what we're saying. And so let's go ahead and play the clip from American Vision's amazing new video with my friend Sye Ten Bruggencate, How to Answer the Fool. Very important video. Make sure you guys grab it.
The fool has said in his heart, there is no God. Now imagine somebody came up to you and said, I don't believe in words. You'd think that he was a fool. You wouldn't pull out a dictionary and give him evidence, and you wouldn't believe him. Somebody comes up to you and says, I don't believe in God. We don't think they're a fool. We give them evidence, and we believe them. When the Bible calls them fools, something has gone wrong.
The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Since what may be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them. And since the creation of the world, God's invisible quality, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without excuse. For although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him, but their thinking became futile and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools. Now, according to that verse, who needs proof that God exists?
No one.
Nobody. Nobody.
I'm bringing them to Christ. I think I'm exposing the folly of denying Christ.
Okay, so you're judging people, is what you're saying.
Is it wrong to judge, sir?
Yeah, 100%. Yeah, only God is the final judge, not you. Of course.
So what I'm doing is wrong.
Yes, 100%.
Stop judging me, sir.
Okay.
How do you know your reasoning's valid?
I don't.
That's right. So if you don't know your reasoning's valid, would it not follow that you can't know anything to be true?
Yes.
Okay, so that's the problem. You could be wrong about everything you claim to know. It follows that you know nothing.
Yes,
but absolutely. The problem is you do know things.
Well, I don't think so. The only thing I do know is that I know nothing.
Do you know that?
Yeah.
That's two. Working in your heart.
I am always open to everything.
Are you open to the fact that child molestation might be right?
Yeah.
You're open to that?
Sure.
So child molestation could be right?
It could be.
You want to get that on camera, guys? Anybody at home, never hire him as a babysitter.
I live in the world of I don't know.
That's right. You know that you live in that world.
I know for a fact that I live in that world.
See, now that's not a world of I don't know. That's it. I know I live in that world. See, that's contradictory.
It is contradictory. That's very often good. all right. That's a good point.
All right. And that was How to Answer the Fool. We'll be right back after this with Sye Ten Bruggencate, AmericanVision.org. Go get him.
Bang your head, who's that? God was dead, tell him to that's how rumors get spread. God is alive and well, it ain't hard to tell. It's time to get live and build, cause our God is real. Bang your head, who's that? God was dead, tell him to that's how rumors get spread. God is alive and well, it ain't hard to tell. Open your eyes for real, son. Yo,
what's up? Welcome back to Apologia Radio. Get us at apologiaradio.com. Also, like the Facebook page, Apologia Radio on Facebook. Like it, share the episodes with your friends. We are brought to you by The American Vision. You can get them at AmericanVision.org. Check them out, guys. Amazing stuff. Great, great ministry. One of my absolute favorite ministries in the world. Also, go to AmericanVision.com. Get some materials. Get some materials on apologetics, some fantastic books, resources, MP3s, even some instructional video DVD sets that will blow your mind and will equip you, will change your life. And make sure when you purchase those things, if you would, on the way out of the store, you can leave a comment as you're finishing your purchase and just let them know, thank you for your support of Apologia Radio. That would be a blessing to us and to them as well. And so I want to talk about this. Sye, you mentioned that when you got into this apologetic, something that really resonates with me, because it was the same for me, brother. And that was that this will not only change the way that you do apologetics and make it devastating and effective and biblical, but it will actually sanctify you.
Absolutely.
Okay. Talk about that for a second. Because for me, Sy, that was one of the most immediate benefits for me as a Christian getting into this apologetic, was that it wasn't just about learning facts and pieces of evidence and potshot stuff. It changed my heart, man.
For sure.
Yeah. So talk about that.
Well, we're going out into the world and we're professing something that we don't really believe. We believe God is a certainty and we profess a probability. That's what all these arguments do, is they lead to a probabilistic deity. And then from there, we use our unregenerate reasoning to try and reason to God, you know, which is just insanity. But this way, you're actually professing the certain God that you believe in. You're no longer talking about probabilities. And this is what I tell people. I say, what if I said to you that I have a wonderful, loving relationship with my wife? I'm just not certain she exists.
Yeah.
You think I was nuts.
Yeah. That's so good you put it that way.
I stop and talk. I say, could you be wrong about everything you claim to know? And they say, yes. Could you be wrong about God? Yes. Mm. How's your relationship with Jesus Christ? Oh, it's fantastic. Well, those two don't add up.
Yeah. Well, that's important. And you know what, Sy? Someone could hear you and I talk about this often, and they'll say, well, Christians don't really reason like that. But the truth is, I mean, there's an example. You can go to, there's a debate. It's between William Lane Craig and Lawrence Krauss. I forgot the name of the debate, so you guys have to search for it online. But listen to that debate. It's free online somewhere. But as the debate opens up, in the first few minutes, I actually lost count as to how many times in the first 5 or 6 minutes William Lane Craig, who professes faith in Christ as Savior and Lord, how many times he used the argument and that God is more probable. He started using statistical probabilities of God being more probable than not. And so that's what you're aiming at, right, Sy?
Well, he freely admits that he is not arguing for the God of Christianity in his debates. Well, then he's arguing for something that I don't believe in.
Yes.
And I don't like to throw other Christians under the bus or people who profess Christianity.
Right.
But I think it's time that people start calling out these bad forms of apologetic. Now, we have to do it with love, because one of my favorite verses is 1 Corinthians 4:7. What do we have that we have not received? So yes, we don't lord it over these people, but we come alongside them and we say, look, that's not the God I believe in. You might want to start defending him biblically.
Amen. See, that's your heart. I know that. See, Sy, that's the big thing. It's your heartbeat is that we would get to a place, and this resonates with me, that we'd get to a place where we're corrected as a church, where the church is sanctified in the reasoning process we have, in a sense of how we approach the world with the apologia, with the apologetic, is we're coming to the world not with a probably kind of God, or a more certain, maybe kind of more certain kind of God, or statistically it's more like 60-40 kind of God is more probable. But we're coming to the world with the certainty that Paul has when he argues at the Areopagus, the certainty of God, that he's raised Jesus up and now he commands men everywhere to repent. Paul is not reasoning. Jesus doesn't reason. The Bible doesn't give us reasoning in such a way that it's maybe God exists. We hope that he does. This really feels good to me. You should join with me in this. It's a certain kind of God. It's a God that says that apart from me, you can't even know anything. It's the God that says that if you reject his existence, you're a fool. It's that kind of God. And we can't. This is what I want to get across. The difficulty here is communicating to Christians, you cannot separate your apologetic from your evangelism, which is what we've been doing. When we try to go to the unbeliever with just the evidences, maybe we convince them. They say, oh, you know, you're right. First cause, second cause. Yeah, that does get me back to maybe like, you know, some sort of like first cause or first mover. Doesn't mean it's Jesus. Doesn't mean it's Jesus. And they'll catch on to that. And Richard Dawkins and Lawrence Krauss were in a discussion. They had exactly that discussion. They said, well, it doesn't mean it's Jesus. It doesn't mean that he died for your sins.
Right.
And that's exactly the point. What we want to do is communicate to believers that we can come to the world with a devastating apologetic that is biblical, that you can mingle together your call to repentance in by exposing the folly of their worldview and their need to turn from their sin to trust in Christ as Savior and Lord, also of their reasoning. We'll be right back with Sye Ten Bruggencate, talking about his new film, How to Answer a Fool, right here on ApologiaRadio.com.
Apologia Radio will be right back.
What's up? This is the gospel heard around the world. It's your host, Jeff Durbin, with the local bear, Luke Pearson.
I like that.
That's right, man.
That's good.
And it's for those of you guys that listen to the show, specifically to hear Joy the girl,
yeah.
I'm probably very disappointed today.
Yeah.
Joy is sick today.
She is sick today.
Sick of us.
Yeah.
Possibly.
I know there's people right now that are like, well, Joy's not on. I'm turning this off.
Yeah, tune out right now.
Yeah.
Well, anyways, we got a great show anyways.
Yeah.
And that's with Sye Ten Bruggencate. Hey, Sye, we didn't mention yet, where can people go to get a hold of you and your ministry?
Well, my website is proofthatgodexists.org, but website for the movie, it's answerthefool.com or howtoanswerthefool.com.
Okay, so howtoanswerthefool.com, and they can go there and they can right now pre-order, I think, at a little bit of a discount. Am I right about that?
That's correct. It's okay. $5 off and free shipping.
$5 off. Free shipping. Everyone, go get the video. And with getting the video, you're not only going to get into a place where your mind is shaped and changed, where you see Christ as more glorious, more powerful than you already see him as, and sort of to get your mind renewed in that sense, but also you'll be supporting the work of Sye and American Vision, and also in this whole thing wrapped together, Apologia Radio. So go get the video, share it with your friends, share it with your family, and so we're very excited about that. Sye, you wanted to fill in something here that needs to be said about this issue.
Right. I don't want people to be at home thinking, well, this is new, you know, that the evidence is the way to defend their faith, and these guys are coming out with something new. I take them back to Scripture when I support this apologetic. As we've discussed, Scripture says it's the fool that has said in his heart there is no God. Now, I say, isn't it too bad that Scripture never tells us how to deal with the fool? Too bad there's no verses. And I say, wait a minute.
Uh-huh.
Proverbs 26, verse 4.
Right.
Do not answer the fool according to his folly, lest you be like him.
Hmm.
Now, I understand that that's not an apologetic chapter of the Bible. However, it's very appropriate for this. Do not answer him assuming that there's no God, or you'll be like him. And like I say, if you get on the atheist airplane, it doesn't matter what you talk about. You're going to his destination.
Mm-hmm.
If you start with the fact that you can argue without starting with God, then you're going to finish there too. But then I say, look at the very next verse. Answer the fool according to his folly, lest he be wise in his own eyes. And that doesn't mean that we put God on the shelf. Now, all of a sudden, you know, we pretend there's no God. We say, no. We start with the presupposition that God exists. You don't. So how do you make sense of these things? We answer them according to their folly, and we ask them to justify them. Now, one of the verses that we talked about earlier was Colossians 2, 2 and 3. In Christ are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And I say, now, why did Paul tell us that? Wouldn't it be nice if Paul were to explain why he actually said that to him? But you have to read the very next verse. The very next verse. I tell you this. So that no one may deceive you by fine-sounding arguments. I mean, it's so clear in Scripture, and,
right.
And that's what I say. When you understand this apologetic, Scripture just opens up. Because Paul tells us all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are hidden in Christ. I tell you this so that nobody may deceive you by fine-sounding arguments.
Yeah.
And that's exactly what's happening. We deny that Christ is the Lord of our reasoning, and we get deceived by the unbeliever's fine-sounding arguments.
Yeah.
And that's something that has to stop. And one last point before we go on is that people can think of their unbelieving friends who have become Christians. Does anybody know even one of them who said, well, what do you know, there is a God?
Yeah.
It's not going from unbelief to belief. It's going from suppressing the truth to professing the truth.
Mm.
That's what happens when a person is converted. He doesn't go from unbelief because the Scripture says everybody knows that God exists, and they're suppressing the truth and unrighteousness.
Exactly. And I'm going to put something on the back of what you said there by way of a visual, I think. Sye appropriately quotes Proverbs 26, and that's where we talk about, answer not a fool according to his folly, lest thou be like unto him. In other words, don't answer him like he answers. Don't be like him, or you'll be like him in your reasoning. Then it says, different way of approaching the issue, not a contradiction, just a different method of approaching him. It says, then answer a fool according to his folly, lest he be wise in his own conceit. That is what Bonson used to refer to as the twofold apologetic method. How do we reason with the unbeliever, with what the Bible calls a fool? And I'm going to say, if you want to get it in a visual, say you're on an ocean and the waves are huge. There's these 30-foot waves coming over the top of your boat. Now, you're in a boat that is steel. It is solid. It is unsinkable. It is in prime condition. It's perfect. There are no holes. It's beautiful, and it is doing well in the storm, and nothing's taking this thing down. All of a sudden now, someone comes paddling up to the side of your boat in a rickety old broke-down boat that's got water seeping into it. They got little paddles, and it's sinking. It's sinking. The wood is rotted. Now, they're looking up at your boat, and you're like, hey, you're stupid for being in that boat. Your boat is dumb, and you're an idiot for being in it. Now, obviously, when you think through it in that sense, that's the absurdity, is I'm good. My boat is solid. And the person's like, get off that boat. Get in mine. You're an idiot for riding in that boat. Well, what you want to do is don't get into that boat with him. Don't go his way. Don't act like him. Don't feel like you need to get into that boat with him because he's reasoning in that way. Don't reason like him. Stay in your boat. And that, in this case, is staying with a commitment of Christ to Christ as Lord and with him as the foundation of your reasoning. But the second way of dealing with this apologetic is you may want to step down for a moment into the boat of the unbeliever and just take his head and push his eyes down and say, look down at your boat. It's sinking. It doesn't work. You're about to go under. Please come get into my boat. Look down. You're about to go under. And that is essentially the twofold apologetic method. It's number one, you don't leap off of the word of God as the foundation of your reasoning with Christ as Lord of all, and particularly of your reasoning and your mind. But you do take the opportunity to step into the unbeliever's worldview to expose the folly of the worldview and show him where his reasoning leads to. Luke, you have something to say?
Yeah, in that same thread I had mentioned earlier on Facebook, we also got another comment, and I think this kind of just goes along with what we're talking about. But their response was, presuppositionalism fails when you begin by stating that you cannot know anything, but the apologist knows what the non-believer thinks in his heart. If you start out like that, you will be dismissed instantly. Sye, please respond to that.
Well, you know, the thing is, if you are dismissed instantly by quoting scripture, so be it. Mm. And people get upset by that. They say if you quote scripture and they turn around and they walk on their, you know, they walk away from you, they think that that's a failure. But these people are being convicted by the truth of God's word. Mm. I'm saying that's not a failure, because we cannot convert anybody. We're commanded to speak the truth in love, and we have to do it in love.
Right.
But if we do it in love and that is met with a rebuff, we can't help that.
That's right. And that's the thing, is people get bothered by that, Sye, is that this apologetic takes the legs off the unbeliever because it shows the folly of their position. And you're quoting the word of God to them, and someone says, well, you know, it's not making any friends, and the person, you know, they're not getting a word in because, you know, and listen, it's not my job as a Christian to necessarily just make buddies with the culture.
Exactly.
I need to expose the folly of the unbelieving worldview, and I need to call them to repentance. It's not about necessarily making friends. Of course, we want to be loved. Of course, we want a good reputation amongst unbelievers. Of course, we want to love the unbeliever. But Sye, your job and my job as believers is to call this person to turn from darkness to light, to trust in Christ as Savior. It's not about having the argument that's soothing to them, correct?
Right. I mean, Jesus did not run after the rich young ruler and say, okay, half.
Right.
You know, and
that's awesome.
What we have to keep in mind, that Scripture talks about sheep and it talks about goats.
Yeah.
But one thing that Scripture never says is that goats become sheep. Mm. It says, my sheep hear my voice. Now, we don't know who we're talking to. It could be a goat. Mm-hmm. And the problem is that when the goats don't accept the message, we try and change it to try and convert goats. And Scripture says that's impossible.
Amen.
And that's why it's a reformed apologetic.
Yeah.
You know, that is up to the work of the Holy Spirit.
Yeah, because what you're saying that's here, Sye, is what you're doing. That by the way, Sye, that was beautiful, man. That was very, very well done. Thank you for that. I'm going to take that from you from now on. I love to just take little snippets of people like that, but that's good. What you're saying is that from a reformed biblical perspective, that we're proclaiming the gospel. The call to repent and believe is a command, and only the Holy Spirit of God is going to illuminate the heart of a person who has fallen to actually believe that message. So what you're saying is that if we're proclaiming repent and believe, and we're showing the foolishness of a rejection of God, then ultimately, if the Holy Spirit brings that person to life, that's to his glory and to his grace, the praise of him and his grace. But we also need to recognize the fact that when we call an unbeliever to repentance and faith, if God, in his grace and in his sovereignty, doesn't open that person's eyes, then that call of repentance is to the glory of God's justice. Because we have to expose the foolishness of unbelief, and that will be to the glory of God's justice in the end.
Right. If you look in the world, what do most apologists do? They try and get the unbeliever to see the truth so that they'll repent.
Mm.
They try to get them to see the truth with evidences so that they'll repent. What does 2 Timothy 2:24 and 25 say? In the hope that God will grant them repentance, leading to a knowledge of the truth.
Amen.
Repentance comes before a knowledge of the truth. The thing is, if you reject God, if you reject the foundation of truth, I cannot convince you that a donkey talked.
Mm.
So you have to repent of your sin against the God you know exists before you can understand any of this. And most apologists are out there looking for a paper fragment that's going to prove that a donkey talked. I mean, are you kidding me?
Right. and just I'm going to say on the back of that, it's not strange that a donkey talks in an unbelieving worldview. Strange things happen in this universe in an unbelieving worldview, like fish becoming philosophers. So that's the point, too, is expose. Christians get like, oh, my gosh, donkeys talk and snake talk. It's like, wait. Pull back. Don't forget the unbeliever talking to you. If he accepts neo-Darwinian, micromutation, macroevolutionary evolution, if he accepts that, he believes that he used to be a fish.
Mm-hmm.
And he also believes that that the universe came from nothing. So miracles aren't really a problem for him. It's not that he has a problem with the miracle. It's that he's at war with his creator.
Right. Becoming a prince is not a fairy tale in the unbelieving world.
Very, very good. Yeah, and so – but he wants to come against you. And that's the point, is what you're doing there is you're showing to wait a second. Don't go there with him. If he says to you a donkey – you believe a donkey talked? It's like, well, God spoke, and so I have certainty about what he did. And it's not strange for me with my worldview of an all-powerful personal God who created all of this to actually cause a creature that he created from nothing to speak. No problem here. But for you, Mr. Unbeliever, let's look down at your feet for a second. Don't forget, you believe that there was nothing and there was something, that non-moral matter became moral, that there was inorganic matter that became organic, that you believe that we were fish that became philosophers. So that's not really a problem for you. Right now, you're showing in your dependence upon uniformity in nature that it's a strange thing that donkeys talk. You're depending upon my God to do that.
Well, look at Paul before Agrippa. He didn't try and prove the resurrection. He said, why do you find it incredible that God should raise the dead?
Amen.
Somebody asked me about Noah's Ark or a donkey talking. You know, I don't try and prove that to him. I say, why do you find it incredible that God should make an ark?
Yes. Very good. So, Sye, we have someone coming into the studio. It's an atheist from he's the president of an atheist club at a local community college. But I wanted to just try to ask you this question. You say a lot, and it bugs the unbeliever a lot. You go right for the heart, and you go for God says you can't know anything apart from him. And so with that, you're going to expose that. You know, do you know that? You'll ask him, do you know that? And how do you know that? But when you're asking them, do you know that, what are some of the responses that they could give?
Well, the very first question I ask them is, could you be wrong about everything you claim to know?
Yes.
And most of them will say, well, being, you know, intellectually honest, I'm going to say yes.
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is, then you're immediately in the realm of absurdity. Because if you say yes, you could be wrong about being wrong about everything you claim to know.
Yeah.
And at that point, once they say yes, it's over. It's done. Preach the gospel to them. Say, well, that's an absurd view. And that's your choice, God or absurdity.
Yeah.
But the thing is, they might say, yes, I can know something for certain. Well, then you ask them how you can do that. And actually, we're coming out with 8 different worldview tracks to how different worldviews account for certainty, account for knowledge, and then we dismantle them. The unbeliever, the atheist, the person who professes atheism, for instance, will say, I know things through my senses, memory, and reasoning. And then you challenge that claim. Well, how do you know that your senses, memory, and reasoning are valid? And you show that they're using them to prove them. It's a vicious circle. Now, people think, well, you know, isn't our view circular? The difference is that we trust in revelation from God, who says that we can use our senses, memory, and reasoning to know some things for certain.
Right.
That does not mean that we're infallible. But the thing is, Scripture says that we can know something for certain using our senses, memory, and reasoning, whereas the unbeliever has no appeal to the God who knows everything to reveal things to us.
Right, right. And so what you're saying here is that, let's use a philosophical term here, Christians believe in a revelational epistemology. We can know things for certain because God, the all-powerful, all-knowing, personal God, has stepped into history and revealed himself to us. That what he has told us, we can know for certain. Certainly there are things that are the secret things of God that we don't know, but what he's given to us is for us and for our children. And so Christians can stand on certainty. Yes, we can know. And we can know with certainty what God has revealed to us such that we can know for certain. And that's the point, is that God has spoken, and that's how we know. And that is unbelievably powerful, and it refutes the unbelieving worldview when you expose the fact that they can't know anything apart from this God. Sye Ten Bruggencate, proofthatgodexists.org. Get the video, americanvision.com. ApologiaRadio.com. We'll be right back.
How many books do you know of that address topics of education and welfare, local government, state government, taxation, money and banking, free markets, courts, war and the military, and the executive power? How many books do you know? actually talk about these topics from a biblical perspective and set forth all of the issues, ideas, the history, and the hurdles, and the blueprints for the way forward. Hi, I'm Joel McDermott with AmericanVision.org. In Restoring America One County at a Time, I cover all these topics and more, showing you how America was once free, how those freedoms were lost, and giving you an uncompromising biblical approach to get those freedoms back. I focus on practical steps, local solutions, personal sacrifices, and it has a multi-generational vision. So don't just sit around talking about Restoring America. Actually do something. And you can start by getting my book, Restoring America One County at a Time, at AmericanVision.org.
What's up? Welcome back to Apologia Radio. This is your host, Jeff Durbin. Hit us up at apologiaradio.com. Also, like us on Facebook. Go to the page, like us, share some of those episodes with your brosifs, with your buddies, with your family. In the studio with the local bear.
This song just took a strange twist.
I know, dead right?
Yeah, I got to tell you something funny.
Okay.
You keep calling me the local bear, which is awesome. Yeah. Last night, I got home, and I was, I think I was helping my dog get ready for bed or something, and she goes, Daddy, you a bear?
You're a bear.
And I was like, what'd
you
yes.
Say? Yes, yes, I am,
yes,
sweetie.
That is
yes,
correct.
That's exactly right. Well, we're back on Apologia Radio today, talking with Sye Ten Bruggencate about the new film. You can get it at AmericanVision.com. You can also, remind me again, Sye, what's the name of the actual website for it? Is it How to Answer a Fool? How does it do it?
HowToAnswerTheFool.com or AnswerTheFool.com.
Okay, and so...
Or AmericanVision.com/fool will get you there as well.
Okay, and so this is Sye Ten Bruggencate, and we're in the second hour now, and we have a special, special guest. We're honored that you joined us today. This is Andre Saleh.
You got it.
I got it. Yep. I got it. I was so... Man, you can trust me. I'm like worried now. I'm like, I'm going to butcher this guy's name. So Andre, the way we met was kind of interesting. I was out doing some outreach at the local Mormon temple. We like to go out and make friends with them and create relationships and bring them the gospel. And so, interestingly, somebody told me, hey, there's this guy I just met. He is the president of the Secular Student Alliance at MCC. And he said he wants to talk to somebody, and he talked about maybe even possibility of a debate. I was like, oh, cool. So he gave me your information. But I just, when you just walked in just now, we just recognized that we actually bumped into each other there.
It was tangential initially. But
yeah, just for a moment, you know, just initial, at least we got to see each other's face. But also, he has a beard.
Yeah.
I just want to say, Sye, here's the thing. I love you. You're a brother in Christ. But you have no beard.
Oh, you don't know that. Oh. I've been growing it just for the show. My goal is to have it in there.
I love you, Sye. So now, okay, Sye, okay, yeah. All right, but we at least have to play for Andre the clip.
Yeah, I just met Andre in the lobby, and so Andre. Oh, hold on.
Oh, did I blow it again? It's my fault every single time.
You can't play both of us. Okay, let me try this again. Andre?
Your beard is good.
We love beards on this show, man. Okay, so you're welcome to the show. So, Andre, you are the president of the Secular Student Alliance. Just tell us about that real fast, what you do and how you got involved.
Oh, certainly. Well, the Secular Student Alliance is a larger national organization. We are an affiliate of that organization at Mesa Community College, and we have a couple of purposes. One, we provide a social group for non-theists that they typically will not have. Since obviously many religious denominations have their groups that they can go to where they have a community there, we provide that setting for people who don't believe in God so that they can have a community as well. Additionally, mainly actually, we're an awareness group. Our purpose is to explain what atheists believe, what we are, and show people that we're really not bad people. We live lives the same as everybody else does. We're moral people. We just don't get our morals from the Bible.
Let's talk about that. And it's a short show, so we're, you know, leaping in. We'd love to get to know you on a more personal level, of course, but just for the purposes of the show, when you talk about what atheists believe, you say we're not immoral people, things like that. Talk to us about that. And Sye joined us as we do this. When I hear you say, as someone who rejects your creator's existence, you know, we're not immoral people, talk about that for a second. Why bring up the issue at all of morality if you believe that you know, and once we were fish that evolved to become philosophers, that, you know, why is morality even an issue for you?
Well, I'd first like to address the use of the term rejection. I wouldn't say that we're rejecting the existence of a creator, because we don't believe that there's enough evidence to support the existence of a creator. So it would be the same as if you were to say you're rejecting the tooth fairy. Not that God goes in the same category as the tooth fairy, but there's not any evidence for that. So it's not really something that you would be rejecting. It's just, you don't believe in it because there's no evidence.
Okay, yeah, I'd like to talk to you about it. Let me hang on to the issue of evidence myself. I want to talk to you about that more later. Okay. But Sye, would you join us here for a second? He says we're not rejecting our creator.
Right. I don't have a problem with professed atheists who claim that they're not making a positive claim, that they're saying, well, I don't have to prove the existence of God. I don't have to prove the non-existence of God. But the problem is that they are making some positive claims such that knowledge, truth, logic, and morality can be made without God. That's an implicit in their claim that they don't believe in God. The implicit thing in that claim is that they can account for truth and knowledge and logic and morality without him. And I think that is something that the professed atheist does have to justify.
Right, right. So, Andre?
I agree with that. I can't say I disagree. I think that every human being has to justify their moral positions in some way or another. I wouldn't ever argue that any person's moral perspective is perfect. Obviously, there's a lot of gray area. But I think that the non-theistic community, and I can speak for a large chunk of us, I obviously can't speak for everybody, but we tend to base our moral perspective on the human condition and improving that condition. We are only here for so long, and this is the only life that we are aware of. There could very well be a hereafter. I don't believe that it's likely, but that could be. But as far as my awareness is concerned, this is the life that we know exists. So our efforts are to improve the well-being of human beings while we can, while we're here, and our moral judgments and our values are based on actions which improve the condition of individuals.
Let me talk to you about that for a second. Our position as Christians would be that that you're an image bearer of God, and that you, like us before Christ, are right now in a position where you're suppressing the truth. We get that from Romans 1. It says that we're suppressing the truth and unrighteousness. And I think that one of the ways I would point this out to you as a Christian, with love and respect to you, recognizing that the only thing that separates the two of us is the grace of God, I would point out to you that you're using things like perfect, things like has to, humans being have to do one thing or the other. You bring up issues of improving the human condition, and I would ask you, with what you're standing on, your rejection of your creator, what must a evolved bag of protoplasm do to other bags of protoplasm? What's a moral requirement for meat-bone protoplasm to do to one another?
You know, I was actually expecting this question to come up specifically.
Yeah.
We can talk about how evolution means that there's no no system of just morality. We can argue about it being relativistic. But if we inevitably look at it, whether we're religious or non-religious, our values are all based on the improvement of our condition. And
I think you missed what I said there. I said, in your worldview, what you're standing on is that you are a highly evolved meatbone protoplasm. And I was asking you to justify your appeal to ought, have to, and what one person has to do to another. My question to you is, with what you're giving to us, your rejection of God and the fact that you are highly evolved protoplasm, what must I do given that worldview? I'm not asking you to give me a system. I'm saying, what's the justification that anybody has to do anything at all, considering that I'm a bag of protoplasm and so are you?
Okay, so what we're doing then is taking the statements that I had made, which would seem to be absolute, had, have, must, things of that nature.
So we don't have
to. I don't think that there is a have or a must, but if we look at the value of human cooperation as one of the key components of how we live our lives in an amicable way with one another, an individual who refuses to participate in a system where human beings throw off murder is something that's acceptable, or rape is something is acceptable, that individual who refuses to participate is not only harming themselves, but everybody else.
Why should I care about harming somebody else? In my worldview, it makes sense. As an image bearer of God, here's what I think I'm going to display to you, is that I think right now that these moments where you talk about oughts and have-tos and everything else and murder and rape as a bad thing, I think right there you're imaging God, because you're recognizing that you are not just a bag of highly evolved protoplasm, and neither is anyone else. You're recognizing that there is value and dignity in other human beings. But you see, in that sense, you're borrowing from my worldview, where I can make sense of that. because I want to agree with you. I think you're reflecting your creator right now. You're showing that you don't want murder and rape as a good thing, because it's not. You're an image bearer of God. But given your worldview, rape and murder really aren't wrong, are they?
Of course they're wrong.
How are they wrong? Why is it wrong for a bag of protoplasm to bump into another one?
Well, what I'm talking about here, and obviously there's not any way for me to say that there's a biological standard for morality. That doesn't exist. But the fact is, human beings have to be able to engage in relationships cooperatively.
Have to. On what basis?
Our survival, for one.
Who cares about surviving? We're stardust.
We're really getting into an issue of semantics here.
What I'm doing right now is I'm trying to show you what you're standing on.
Oh, of course. I understand where you're coming from, but I'm not making any absolute statements based on biology. I have to accept the assumption that we work in a cooperative society, which is just something which is evidenced by tens of thousands of years of human cooperation.
But is it necessary for us to cooperate given your worldview of highly evolved humanoids?
Could you elaborate on that statement?
Your worldview is I'm assuming you're an atheist, so
yes,
you believe in Darwinian evolution.
I do.
And so from nothing, there was something. Do you agree with Krauss, Lawrence Krauss?
I'm not a cosmologist or a physicist.
Well,
so
I'm just saying in the sense that you believe that obviously there's no God and we're essentially stardust. There's, you know, that's kind of where we're at. That's what his claim is. You're local. He's a local professor that's promoting this, and so I'm figuring, you know, there's a lot of cooperation amongst the organizations. And so with that, I would say that right now you need to, the issue here is not intellectual. It's not a lack of evidence for you. I would say that is clearly you're standing on your rejection of God. But when I ask you to justify your claims about moral oughts and must do and everything else, you're not giving me anything with atheism. Why, given your atheism, ought I to do anything?
Well, this can't be. I can't tell you you ought to do anything. You can't derive an is from an ought. Even if you're familiar with the works of David Hume, this is something that's very clearly outlined.
Right.
Logically, that's not possible.
Right.
But
so why are you imposing that upon others as an atheist?
Well, I don't impose upon anybody. Everyone is welcome to draw their own conclusions,
okay.
But I feel that inevitably, just looking at human history, we draw conclusions.
Would you tell the murderer? Well,
here's
what I mean by impose. As an atheist, would you tell the murderer he ought to stop?
Well, of course. What
right
so you
do? You do impose your morality.
This is a societal moral.
Upon the atheist.
Let me pose this question then. If not for some sort of divine law, do you believe that human beings eventually would have come to the conclusion that we shouldn't kill each other and shouldn't steal each other's things?
Yeah, well, it's a mistaken claim for the atheist to believe that Christians believe in oughts and everything else based on the capricious, you know, decree of God. Like he says, well, today, you know, you shouldn't do this, and today you could do this or not. We believe that all of morality is based on an objective standard, and that is God's own character. It's God himself that is the objective standard. And so when we talk about what we ought to do, it's based on an objective standard, which is God's own character, his own nature, himself. And we're reflections of God, image bearers of God. And so we have that moral requirement to be like him. And so the standard is not my own thoughts. It's not the society I live in. It's the objective standard of God himself. And so when I say you shall not murder, it's not because I think so or because society's gone with me. It's because it actually is a contradiction to the very nature of God himself, who is love. And so we'll be right back right after this break with Sye Ten Bruggencate, Andre, Luke, and Jeff Durbin, ApologiaRadio.com.
Apologia Radio. We'll be right back.
What's up? Welcome back to the Gospel Heard Around the World, Apologia Radio. Exciting episode today. Our friend Andre from the Secular Student Alliance came to join us. We feel blessed to have you on with us today, by the way. And Sye Ten Bruggencate, proofthatgodexists.org. All right, so let's open up into this segment. I thought we'd give Sye an opportunity to kind of talk with Andre a bit, since I kind of took over the first part of the segment there. Sye, when you listen to Andre, he's a sweet guy, he's a nice guy, he seems like a really intelligent guy. What would you, as a Christian that loves him, want to say to him to show him where you're coming from?
Well, first, I'd be very sure to point out that when he says he does not believe in God, he's actually committing blasphemy. And that's not a good thing for him. And him coming on this show is just not a fun philosophical discussion, that he's getting a lot of truth today.
Yes.
And people are judged according to the amount of truth they get. So that's why I say if he dies in his sin, you know, without the blood of Jesus Christ covering his sin, then this is not a good day for him. And that's why we want to be very clear and very gentle with him to explain this to him. Now, I know in that segment you were talking about morality, and I rarely get into the moral discussion with the unbeliever anymore, because what I say is that you need God to even formulate arguments about morality.
Yeah.
But I will meet them on that level, and I will talk to them, and I will expose some of the difficulty that they have when they talk about morality. Now, one of the things that Andre had said is that our morality is not perfect. And my question for him, before I get into the foundations of knowledge, my question to him is, what is perfect morality?
I can't answer that question. I don't think there's a lot of gray area in the area of morality, but one thing in particular from what you said that I'd like to challenge is my position on morality is if you need a deity, some sort of celestial lawgiver to tell you that it's wrong to murder people or to rape people, it's not religion that the person lacks, it's empathy. I think we find, as we interact with other human beings, care for one another regardless of whether or not we're religious. And I can say this as someone who does not believe in God. I consider myself to be a rather gentle person. I don't hate anybody. I don't wish poor experiences on any human being. And I don't derive that from any sort of religious basis.
Okay, but here's the problem, and this is why I rarely talk about morality, is because people go off on tangents and they miss the main question. Because when you say that our morality is not perfect, you have to know what perfect morality is to say that our morality doesn't meet with that. So when you say that our morality is not perfect and you can't say what is perfect, you're actually refuting yourself. But now I'd just like to go into the foundations of our knowledge to
right.
even discuss morality.
Right.
And this is a question I'd like to ask you. Could you be wrong about everything you claim to know?
Could I? I suppose it's possible. I do have to accept the assumption that my senses do provide me accurate information.
Right.
And that's an assumption. Granted, it is an assumption, but it's an assumption that I accept because the physical world is all that I can perceive.
Well, however, you know, if your senses are not, if they're not valid, you couldn't know that. But an assumption is a faith-based claim. But let me just explain what the problem is when you say that it's possible you could be wrong about everything. What you've given up is you've given up knowledge, and let me explain that to you. If you were to ask what was the speed of the road outside my house right now, and I said it's 30 miles per hour, but I could be wrong, would I know it?
No, but the statement that you're making may be based on something reasonable. If you'd seen the sign repeatedly and you think that's what it may be from prior experiences, it's not a faith-based statement. It's a statement based on what you recall, but your recollection could be incorrect.
Well, let me explain that then. So when you say that I don't know it because I could be wrong, and you've admitted that you could be wrong about everything, that means you've abandoned knowledge and you don't know anything. And that's what Scripture says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of knowledge. All the treasures of wisdom and knowledge are hidden in Christ. Because with that statement, you've given up knowledge, but you will make knowledge claims for the rest of this show. And that's the problem. And that's why I urge people who do this, who are listening to this, who listen to people make knowledge claims when they've abandoned knowledge, that they need to repent. Because Jesus Christ did not only die to save souls for eternity, he died to save reasoning now. And I'd love to keep engaging you, but I'd like to... If you make a knowledge claim, I am going to hold you to that, and I'm going to ask you how you can know that when you could be wrong about everything.
Okay. Well, I don't mind you holding me to that standard, but see, I think the difference between our approaches here, and this is by no means intended to be an attack at all, but my position, I am admitting that I have to operate under an assumption in order to make any claims about anything. I have to assume that I exist. I have to assume that I'm conscious. I have to assume that my senses are providing me accurate information. So I acknowledge that could be an inaccuracy. I could very well be wrong. The position that's being that I believe you are claiming, and correct me if I'm wrong, is certainty on things which are beyond our ability to know. Not only do you have to be able to justify with a statement of truth that there is, in fact, a God, but you have to also be able to state that you know the will and the mind of this God, which is something beyond our reach. I admit that I do not know everything. There are many things that I may be proved wrong on in the future, and I also admit that, granted, my perception could very well be flawed. I accept that I am making assumptions, but faith does not accept assumptions. It makes statements of certainty without acknowledging the possibility that it could be wrong.
Well, let me ask you this question then. Are you saying that there is no absolute certainty?
Am I saying is there no could you elaborate on
that? Are you saying
that
there's no such thing as absolute certainty?
I wouldn't make a claim on that either way.
See, that's the problem. Because what you have been doing is you've been making knowledge claims. You're saying that things are beyond our knowledge. But that's a certain knowledge claim, which you cannot make unless you start with God. It refutes your worldview because everything that you make, and like I don't like to jump in because people, you know, they accuse me of that. I let you finish your sentence. But every one of your sentences is a knowledge claim, which you cannot justify without God. And if you make a knowledge claim, like in the future, I don't want to be ignorant and make it appear as though I'm jumping in, but I want to hold you to that. When you make a knowledge claim, I want to know, how do you know that? How do you know, for instance, that these things are beyond our knowledge?
Okay. Well, to that point, first, I'm going to say you're particularly good with dialectics. That's something that I can compliment you on.
You know that,
Socrates,
sir.
Would be proud.
But you know that I'm particularly good with dialectics.
My observation tells me this.
Okay. Now, are your observations valid?
I'd like to just point out, though, the statements that you're making are also knowledge claims.
Well,
you
know that, sir.
But he can make the knowledge claims as our positions. But he asked you a question, though. What would your answer be to what he asked you?
Could you repeat the question, sir?
Well, I was asking how you can know anything for certainty, and you've denied certainty. And, you know, that's all I'm going to say is I'm going to hold you to that. When you make a knowledge claim, I'm going to ask how you know these things.
No, I have not denied certainty. I refuse to answer the question because I can't claim either side of it.
Is it certain that you've not denied certainty?
This is an issue again where we're nitpicking with the use of specific words.
Are you certain that we're nitpicking?
Are you certain that I'm nitpicking or not? Are you certain that we're having this conversation?
Okay, let's just contrast the two worldviews. I believe in an all-knowing, all-powerful being. Yeah. Surely you would admit that such a being can reveal things to us such that we can know them for certain. And since you've abandoned knowledge, you would have no basis for even to argue with that claim. So according to my worldview, I can have certainty. And if you want to dispute that claim, I would ask you, how are you certain that I can't?
Well, why is the burden of proof on me? Why aren't you required to prove to me that the deity that you believe in is able to provide you with that basis for certainty?
Well, what I'm saying is that you have already abandoned knowledge. Now, I'll ask you, let's put that on the table. Would it be possible for God to reveal things to us such that we can know them for certain?
This would say that we would have to accept the possibility that a God does in fact exist.
Right.
However, if we're going with that assumption, again, we are making assumptions and we are making claims, in your case, of certainty that there is a God. We've already acknowledged
right.
that certainty
isn't something.
I'm making
that assumption. With that assumption, can I know things
guarantee.
For certain?
But the question is, with that assumption, can he know things for certain? I'm going to get right back. Next segment with Andre from the Secular Students Alliance and Sye Ten Bruggencate and our local bear right here on ApologiaRadio.com.
Apologia Radio. We'll be right back.
Every truth that bleeds, I close my eyes.
Welcome back to the Gospel Heard Around the World. This is Jeff Durbin. With Apologia Radio, get us at apologiaradio.com. Support us, pray, support, go to the page, share the episodes. Also, go to americanvision.com, pick up some materials. In particular, pick up Sye's new video. Tell them in the comments, thank you for the support of Apologia Radio. In the studio with the local bear, rawr, like that, there you go. Luke Pearson.
And I can't play the correct one because
I'm playing my music. Yeah. See, I did that on purpose. And also Andre from the Secular Students Alliance and Sye Ten Bruggencate. All right, so you had a question posed to you as we came into the last segment, okay? And what's your answer?
Could the question be repeated for the
Sye, do you remember the question?
Let me modify a little bit.
Okay.
Is it impossible for God to exist?
Is it impossible?
Yes.
You're asking that I prove a negative, which is logically
No. I'm not asking you to prove a negative. I'm not asking you to prove that he does not. I'm asking you for the possibility that he does.
Is it possible that a God exists?
Yes.
I would venture as far as to say that it is possible for the existence of a deistic God. I'm sure you're familiar with Aquinas' five proofs. That's probably the most reasonable argument I could see for the existence of a God.
Well, okay. Are you saying it's impossible for the Christian God to exist?
I didn't say that.
Is it impossible for the Christian God to exist?
No, absolutely not. I just find it improbable.
Okay, well, the Christian God reveals things to us such that we can know them for certain. So when you concede that it's not impossible for my God to exist, for the Christian God to exist, you've conceded an avenue to certainty to me. And now that's why I ask, how can you know anything for certain? Because you say the burden is on me. That's also a certain knowledge claim, but I'm glad to prove my point. The proof that God exists is that without him, you can't know anything. Now, if you conceded according to my worldview, I can know things for certain. And I ask you again, how can you know anything? How can you justify even one claim that you make?
Oh, I can make the same argument, though, about the just natural laws of the universe. If we're going to base it on the assumption that the existence of the Christian God or the possible existence of the Christian God creates a highway to certainty, why can I not make the same statement that the universe itself is capable of providing certainty?
Because you have admitted that you could be wrong about everything you claim to know. And
yes.
If you want to retract that claim and make a claim from naturalistic laws that grant you certainty, I'm all ears.
Well, you're offering me the opportunity to retract the claim, but I am not going to retract the claim because my statement was not a claim of certainty. I'm saying it's
okay.
If we're going to admit the assumption that it's possible for a God to exist which can provide a highway towards certainty, then it is
right.
Also equally possible that that certainty can exist in a universe which does not
deal
with the assumption.
Well, I deny that, but I'd like you to explain that possibility for me.
Well, I can't. We're dealing in the world of the not real. I can't extrapolate the possibility of that in the same way that you
you're offering the hypothetical
yes,
that natural laws give
you
certainty, and I'm all ears, because you would need your senses, memory, and reasoning mm-hmm. in order to glean certainty from these natural laws, from the world, and you're a fallible person, so I'd like to know how you can have certainty from that position. And, I mean, you posited it, so I'd love to hear an explanation for that.
Of course, but you're also offering the option for an infallible God as a fallible human being, so I think
right,
we're,
but an infallible
we're offering...
God,
we're
an
offering...
infallible God can grant us certainty, as you've admitted, so now I'm asking you to provide your justification for certainty.
I could simply say that the laws of physics may be infallible, but...
Yes, and I'd like you to justify that.
Yeah, I need you to justify then for me the possibility that your God is infallible.
Well,
I mean, there's
I don't want to go over the same ground again. But
of
what
course.
You do, you've granted me an avenue to certainty, and I'd like to say, I'd like just to ask you how, according to your worldview, how you can know things for certain. I mean, if you want to posit infallible laws, I'll be happy to go there.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, if we're arguing things that neither of us believe, we're just wasting time.
Well, of course, I actually agree. I don't think that this is a topic worth. Worth discussion because we're dealing entirely with the hypothetical. I mean,
are you certain that we're dealing with hypotheticals?
Well, with the assumption that what I'm observing is real, I have to accept that we are dealing with hypotheticals.
Are you certain that you have to accept
that? I've already told you that I am accepting certain assumptions about my senses.
Right. But the thing is, you're also making certain claims that you're accepting.
Yes, within the context of my assumptions about my senses.
That assumption is a faith-based claim. And this is what unbelievers criticize Christians of, but we're actually turning the tables. We're showing that it's the atheist, it's the person who denies the existence of God. Their foundation is assumptions, and assumptions are faith-based claims. So this man, his worldview is based on faith, and not only is it based on faith, it's based on blind faith.
Do you get that point? What he's saying, Andre, is that a Christian has faith, but it's a trust in a God who gives us certainty, who cannot lie. And so when we trust in him, there's obviously a trust or faith coming there. But it appears to us that your position with the rejection of God, it appears that yours is a blind faith, is really what it is. Because you're saying you trust in these physical laws and your senses and reasoning and your ability to adjust to what's around you and take information in, but you can't give any justification as to why any of that is valid, or even why you can trust that the future will be like the past.
Well, an assumption acknowledges perfectly well the possibility that I could be wrong.
Mm-hmm.
The assumption accepting God as truth does not acknowledge any possibility for it being
wrong.
Are
you certain of that?
And we'll pick that up right after this for a longer last segment, 14 minutes right after this, with Andre and Sye Ten Bruggencate, our local bear Luke Pearson, and me, Jeff Durbin, right here at ApologiaRadio.com.
Apologia Radio will be right back.
What's up? Welcome back to the Gospel Heard Around the World, brought to you by the American Vision. Get them at AmericanVision.org or AmericanVision.com. Like us on Facebook. Like us a lot.
Yes.
Share us with your friends. Get them to like us as well.
Yes.
We're back here with the local bear, Luke Pearson with a beard.
What's going on?
All right, quickly, what's the story behind
the
song?
Okay, so I played this song. That's the OC Supertones, going old school a little bit there. I think that's from 2006.
Okay.
But I played that song because I originally learned about presuppositional apologetics from Matt Morginsky, who's the lead singer of the Supertones.
Really?
Yeah, I was at a winter camp. I think I just graduated high school. I was probably like 19 or 20, something like that. And he was the speaker at the winter camp, and it was all about presupp. And I was like completely blown away by it. So that I had the pleasure of learning about it then. I remember it took me like a good 6 months, maybe even to a year, to even be able to say the word presuppositional.
Yeah.
That was a challenge.
Yeah.
But anyways, that's where it started. That's why I played that song. So I wanted to give a shout out.
Right on. Shout out.
Yep.
To what are they called? Supertones?
Supertones, yeah.
Right on. All right. Well, this is Jeff Durbin, one of your hosts here with Andre from the Secular Students Alliance and Sye Ten Bruggencate. Sye just came out with a new film. With American Vision, you can pick it up by going to AmericanVision.org or HowToAnswerTheFool.com. Pick up the video, by the way. Pick up the first part of this broadcast to understand the context of that in Scripture, what all that means, and how we do this. So we exited the last part of the segment, Andre, and what I was pointing out to you was that your position is a faith commitment as well, but it appears that yours is a blind faith because you have no justification for your appeal to your senses or your reasoning or even to the universe, the physical laws. You don't know, considering that you don't believe in a God who governs the universe, the sovereign God who controls all things and carries it along. You don't even know that the physical constants will be constant the next 5 seconds from now or 10 seconds from now. And so what we're saying to you is we believe you're an image bearer of God, but your problem is, like us, before Christ, you're sin. And you need to turn to God, to trust in him, to be forgiven and reconciled to God through faith in him. But what we're saying here is that there's all these moments of your life in this last broadcast where you've had these, I would say, these moments of imaging God. You've talked about morality and what is right, what we ought to do. You've made knowledge claims. And what Sye and I have been trying to do is really point out to you that with your atheism, standing on it, you have no basis to make any of these claims you're making. You're essentially borrowing from our worldview to make sense of yours.
Mm-hmm. Well, and I will contest something in your reintroduction of the discussion here, because I think I've made a perfectly sound argument for the worldview of Christianity lacking the same basis. If we're going to be discussing assumptions as to whether or not my senses could be flawed, whether or not I can trust the physical constants, this is something that a Christian must assume as well. But they assume one thing further, that it comes from a divine creator of some sort who has orchestrated all of that. I think with this discussion, though,
Hold on, Sye, you have something to say?
Sorry, go on.
To that? Go ahead, Sye.
I was just going to say, could you be wrong about the fact that you've made a sound argument?
Well, I think we're beating a dead horse that wasn't alive to begin with. This discussion can occur with really any religious perspective.
Could you be wrong about that,
Christianity? Well, of course I could be wrong
about
that.
Well, then you have to stop making knowledge claims.
We're you also would need to stop making knowledge claims in that case, because you're operating under the assumption that you know that the Christian God is the right God to
provide
you.
Are you certain that I'm making that assumption?
If this were the other round, other way around, I could easily ask you every time you make a statement if you're certain. I think this is why I'm saying.
But you conceded my avenue to certainty.
Well, this is why I'm saying we're beating a dead horse. A Hindu could make the same claims about their pantheon
of
gods.
Certain of that,
a Muslim
sir?
Could make
well,
the same
let me,
claims.
Let me correct this. What we're not doing here, Andre, and just if you can hear us, maybe this will clarify it. We're not making an authoritarian claim like we're saying, well, I have certainty you don't nanny nanny boo boo, like, you know, kind of a thing, and you can throw it back at us. What we're saying is that we can make that claim and justify it with certainty, but given your rejection of God and your atheism, your naturalistic worldview, you can't justify these claims to knowledge. And so it's not really just an authority claim throwing it back at you, and you can throw it back at us. We're asking you to justify it. Can you justify your appeals to knowledge given your atheism? Start with your atheism.
Well, my position is that I would imagine, of course, I'm not meaning to condescend to anybody here. We're all human beings, and I would imagine we're fairly equal in brain power. I doubt that anybody here has any mental faculties beyond that of the average atheist as far as their ability to interpret and perceive the universe. So
watch this. All these assumptions that are happening right now, you're speaking as somebody who believes that we evolved from the soup. And so you're making claims as to brain power and everything else, but I mean, the thing is that you can't justify any appeal to laws of logic in the first place, because I'm assuming you're talking about brain power. Are you appealing to just this matter that's in my skull?
This is where when I say we're beating a dead horse here, if we removed the God assumption from
is it wrong to beat a dead horse in an argument? Well, watch this. Is it wrong given atheism to beat a dead horse in an argument?
Well, of course not. But it doesn't make it very interesting.
So why make
as an
the
argument.
Point? Why make the claim? Who cares about interesting given your worldview?
Well, this is one of the reasons why I feel this is becoming an argument of I know you are, but what am I?
No, it's not. What I'm doing here is I don't want to allow you to move past a point where I show you an inconsistency in what you're standing on. Mm-hmm. You talk about we shouldn't do this because it's beating a dead horse. You shouldn't do this, and the argument is flawed. But given your atheism, you're a bag of stardust, and so am I. Why is there any standard of what is good brain power versus non-good brain power? I mean, you can't even, as far as I'm concerned, with your atheism, make an appeal to universal laws of logic.
Well, what I was saying as far as brain power goes isn't that one person's brain power is good and the other isn't. What I'm saying
Where's that standard
is
coming from,
I have...
Who makes that standard? Who decided what good brain power is versus non-brain power?
Okay, we can toss that that discussion topic, but we're getting back into the I know you are, but what am I
No,
situation.
We're not, actually. I'm just showing because you. Your claim is that we are evolved from the soup to where we're at today. Mm-hmm. We're protoplasm. And yet you're holding Sye and I to certain logical laws about beating dead horses and you shouldn't do that and everything else. And so what I'm asking you is given your atheism, we would say your rejection of God, how are you making these claims? Justify them given your atheism.
How can an individual make a claim of certainty about the existence of a God without accepting certain assumptions?
Well, the thing is you've already granted our position. That if our position is true, we can have certainty. We're just trying to hold you to the fire as to how you can know anything. But you've admitted that your worldview is based on assumptions.
No pun intended on holding
well,
me to the fire.
Well, let me just finish. You came into the program saying that you did not believe in God because of a lack of evidence. But I'm going to read for you the description, the definition of the word assumption. It's a proposition accepted without proof or evidence as a basis for some further conclusion. So the thing is, the foundation of your worldview has no evidence. So then when you come here and then ask us to provide evidence, I think what we're trying to do is just hold up the mirror and show that since your worldview is based on assumptions, your worldview is based on a position that has no evidence and no proof.
Okay. Well, I'd like to mention that this wasn't the discussion that I anticipated having here. What I was expecting was a discussion about atheists and atheism and our roles in society. But I'm more than happy to have this discussion as well. If we're going to go with... The assumption itself, the charge that I cannot make any claims of certainty based on assumptions. Oh, and by the way, I did, of course, grant you the avenue to certainty with the possibility that the Christian God could exist because I'm reasonable in that regard. But you haven't been willing to grant me the assumption that the universe itself could potentially be infallible.
Well, no, I would just like for you to tell me how that makes sense in your worldview. I didn't deny it. I'm just saying... Could you explain that to me? So how can a universe to be infallible would have to have some kind of a knowledge, and I don't know how something that's immaterial or even matter can have knowledge, and how that can be translated to you to have knowledge. So I'm not saying I'm denying it, I'm just asking you to explain it.
So you have granted me the possible avenue to certainty there?
No, not at all. I'm just asking you to explain. I'm saying it's impossible, and if you're saying that it's possible, I want you to explain how that's possible.
Okay. Well, I can't explain how that's possible, but what I would like to interject into this conversation is that, now this granted, based on my observation, which could very well be flawed, I will grant that assumption again, for lack of a better term, into the discussion. I do not have a choice in the matter, from what I can observe, as to whether or not I can perceive the natural world in the way that I do.
Are you certain that you don't have a choice, sir?
I admitted that there is an assumption there. However, you do have the choice as to whether or not you will believe in a deity. I don't. The choice as to whether or not I see light isn't my decision. It happens whether I act upon it or not. If
Are
I,
you
I
certain
can,
of that,
I can
sir?
Tell myself that I don't wish to see it. I can try to block it out and tell myself that the light isn't there. But I don't have any ability to manipulate the reality that I live in such a way that it's different.
Can I use what you just said there about the light can help, but you have no ability to block it? It's going to expose regardless. That's what we're saying about where every atheist is at. Understand, our position is that all of us are image bearers of God and we're fallen, we're rebels. And that the truth about God and his existence and his immanence is impossible to move away from. And so with your example of light, I would actually expose that and bring that back to this issue of God. We would say this, is that your position as an image bearer of God is inescapable. And this entire time, you have displayed a suppression at times in your life of your position before God, because you're imaging God all over your life. And then when we point it out to you, you try to push it back down again. You make knowledge claims, and then when we point it out to you, you can't do that with your atheism. You push it back down again. But yeah, I can't make those certain claims. And we talk about the universe and appealing to laws as that the future be like the past, all those different things. We point that out to you. You realize with your atheism, you can't have that. So you push that back down. Well, and so our call to you is this. I'll let you and Sye finish up here. Mm-hmm. My call to you is this, is just know this. Listen, there's no difference between Sye and me and Luke and you in the sense of image bearers of God that are fallen and sinners. But what we're saying is this, is that Christ is God in the flesh. He lived perfectly, died for sinners, and rose from the dead. And the call is this, is that you would turn to him, to trust in him for salvation and forgiveness. That's the love and the concern we have for you. And we're saying this, that until you do that, your worldview is going to constantly collapse at every turn.
Well, in response to that, I think that, of course, the two of you are continually bringing up the knowledge claims. However, I shouldn't have to regularly reassert that I am making assumptions that I perceive this reality.
You shouldn't have to?
I shouldn't have to because
Who made that rule? Who made that law? You shouldn't. Well, is there an obligation?
This is precisely my concern. Is within this conversation, I have already established that the atheistic worldview depends on assumptions that things exist. It depends on assumptions that our senses aren't lying to us.
Is lying okay? What if your senses were lying to you?
But what I'm pointing out here is that I've had to continuously reassert these assumptions when I'm making my statements, because my statements are continuously being challenged.
Well,
what I'd like to see
is that
we accept that I am making
them with
assumption.
The things that you say.
Right. That's what we're pointing out to you, is that you're telling us about your worldview, but then
yes.
When we ask you to justify these claims, you can't do it and you won't do it.
But we need to understand that my worldview is within the context of the assumptions.
Yeah, no, we understand that, but we're asking you to justify these claims with your atheism, given what you're standing on, not borrowing from our worldview, where image bearers of God are valuable and have dignity, where there are oughts, where there are laws of logic which are universal and unchanging. Your worldview is bags of meatbone protoplasm are bobbing on the surface of the cosmos. Dawkins says there is no good, there is no evil, there is only blind and pitiless indifference. So with that, no God, no purpose, no meaning, you say we have a very short time to be here, we got to live our lives to the fullest. I'm asking you with that atheism to justify any of the claims you've made today to knowledge, to physical constants, anything.
Of course, I mean, if we take Dawkins out of context like that, that's obviously a claim that can be made.
That wasn't out of context. Dawkins believes, like Krauss, I went to his lecture, that we're stardust and we're apes.
Well, of course
we're
stardust.
There is no good and no evil. It's blind and pitiless indifference.
Everything that makes up the human body, physically speaking, it was forged in the heart of a star.
Okay,
could you be wrong about that, Andre?
Minus hydrogen, of course.
Could you be wrong about that, Andre?
Well, we're getting back to this original issue with
right, because you make knowledge claims.
Within the context of my assumption, the approach that we're taking here, we have acknowledged that I am making an assumption, but the approach that you're taking with challenging me is very childish.
It's not allowing you. In a way, he's doing, Andre, he's not allowing you to, as an atheist, borrow capital from our worldview to make sense of yours.
Well, I don't think
you already granted this. I'll give you this. You said you're stardust. Okay. And so, as stardust, highly evolved stardust, with no God above you, only sky. That's bobbing along in the cosmos in a blind and pitiless indifference situation. My call to you is that with that worldview, you have collapsed because you have done everything today to violate that position.
And if I may state really quickly, yeah. I understand this position, but my worldview and my perception of morality lacks the same basis that the Christian worldview lacks. We can all make arguments over morality, but inevitably we have to accept that there are assumptions being made, whether that's the assumption of an eternal God or the assumption that human beings have to cooperate with one another.
And what's in our position to you is this, is that you just showed the suppression of truth because you're stardust talking about morality. And it shows the collapse of the atheistic worldview. Sye Ten Bruggencate, thank you for joining me on the show today.
Thanks for having me.
Hit him up, guys. Get the video at AmericanVision.com. Andre, thank you for blessing us with your presence today.
Yes,
Luke, the local
you.
Bear,
oh,
we'll
pleasure.
Check you out next time at ApologiaRadio.com.
That was quick.
Yes.
That was quick. I watched the clip early this morning, and it caught me off guard.
Hey,
a bit. And if
sorry,
I had
do
known,
you want to talk to Sye?
What's that?
He just asked if you want to talk to Sye.
I can hear.
Oh, hey, Sye. Well, Jeff took his headset off.
Yo!
There's one thing I want to make perfectly clear, though. I wanted to reiterate on the show, but maybe you could talk about that on another show, is that we're not saying that Andre doesn't know things. we're not saying that he doesn't know things for certain.
Yeah.
Because the claims that he makes, many of them are true. He just can't justify them without God.
Andre, go ahead. He's still on. He's still on side.
Okay. Well, and see, I understand that I'm not in any way taking anything that you're telling me as an ad hominem attack. I understand we both hold different worldviews, and I'm glad that you're willing to discuss this with non-theists. But my position is that the Christian argument for it is just as fallible. It requires just as many assumptions. I was going to say the fact is the position that I hold is a position I think involves more humility, because I have to admit that I don't know. I can't, even if there were a God, if we did prove in fact that the Christian God did exist, there wouldn't be any way with my mental faculties that I could say I know the will or the mind of that deity.
What if he reveals himself to you?
That would be a different story.
And that's what he's done.
The deity has not done that.
But see, that's exactly the claim, though, is that God has revealed himself in history and specifically also in his word. So God has given us what you're saying you would need.
Where historically do you mean?
Well, here's the problem, because the thing is, you know, when you make these claims, you know, that God has not revealed himself to me, we don't only say that claim, we also evidence it. Because when you talk about logical arguments, when you talk about fallacies, when you talk about truth and knowledge, that is evidence that you know this God, because you cannot make sense of these things without him.
That's evidence of my consciousness.
Well, the thing is, how do you get universal, abstract, invariant laws of logic from your consciousness?
I don't know the answer to that. I have to admit that I don't
know.
You know
that God exists.
That doesn't mean that it's outside of the reach. I do not know that there is a God.
Well, then how do you justify the logic that you use in your argumentation?
What I can tell you is that just because we don't know now doesn't mean that we won't know. Science is constantly.
But you're using logic now. That's the problem. Right. You're using it now.
Because it's what I have to work with.
Okay, but the thing is,
we have to work with the instruments that we have.
But you're appealing to an absolute standard of logic, which you cannot justify. So you're doing something that's inconsistent with your worldview.
And I have acknowledged that I could very well be wrong. That's,
well, then you
that
can't
certainly
use logic.
Is a possibility. But with the tools that I have available to me are the tools that we have available to us as people are what we need to use.
But you've stolen those tools.
Right.
I have stolen those tools. Okay.
Well, you get what he's saying. Get what he's saying, just so you understand. Mm-hmm. He's saying you're an image bearer of God who is borrowing from God's worldview, what he's created, to make sense of your world, although when you look at your feet, your atheism is militating against what you're doing.
Okay. Well, I mean, if I'm going to be charged with the theft of those tools, how do you know that I have stolen those tools? I mean, can you prove that these tools actually come from God? We can't prove that.
Yes, we can, by the impossibility of the contrary. And I'll explain that to you. Because logic is universal, it's not made of matter, and it does not change. God is universal, he's not made of matter, he does not change. Logic makes sense in our worldview, and he's revealed that he is the source of logic, he's the source of all things. So according to our worldview, logic makes sense. Now the thing is, you want to use logic against us, but you're saying, well, I don't know where it came from. Well, we do know where it came from.
You assume, though, that it is the Christian God. I mean, how do you know that it's not
There's
Christian?
There's only one God, and if you want to argue against
Thor,
that,
Ashtaroth,
then
or Mithra. I mean, I would argue that everyone in this room is an atheist about most of the thousands of gods that have existed.
Well, let me explain that to
you. I simply take it one step further.
I'll be happy to explain that to you, because it says in Scripture, all the gods of the world are idols, but the Lord made the heavens.
Which is
We're
also
not
the
atheistic
claim that's
towards other gods. We're not idolaters. There is only one God. But what happens with atheists is that very often they see the bankruptcy of their own worldview, and they say, well, what about these gods? Well, they abandon their atheism in order to argue for their atheism.
You're making the statement, though, as if Christianity is the only one that's mutually exclusive. I mean, I could point out the fact that the majority of the world's religions, especially the monotheistic ones, are mutually exclusive. There are even mutually exclusive forms of Christianity. I mean, Calvinism and Catholicism are not compatible
worldviews. Well, the problem
is,
when you level that objection, you're already borrowing from our worldview, because you're saying, I could point out things that are mutually exclusive, and I say, what's your basis for doing that without God? What's the basis for even leveling an logical argument against us without God? And I'm saying that if you want to have that discussion, that's a discussion for Christians who can justify logic and knowledge and truth.
Can I just point one thing out here? Just Andre, you hear me on this?
Yeah.
The point is watch, in order to argue right now these points you're making with Sye and I, you have to assume things that just do not comport with your worldview. For example, you're assuming the uniformity in nature. Okay, the future will be like the past experience will be like future experience. You're assuming universal, invariant laws of logic, that are immaterial. You're assuming value and dignity in human beings. You're also assuming the moral requirement Sye and I have right now not to lie to you or abuse you in this conversation.
Well, I assume that you're not lying and abusing to me because you're decent people.
Well, my point is that you're assuming that we have value and dignity and we should treat each other this way. Watch this. All those things do not comport with your atheism. They do comport with our worldview, which shows that you're imaging God, we would say.
Even his statement that we're decent people appeals to an absolute standard of decency. Yeah. What is that without God?
You see the point?
Okay. Well, see, you have to make the assumption, though, that these things come from your God specifically.
We're making the certain claim that they come from God.
You're making a claim of certainty about something which cannot be known to be certain.
We've already granted that God could reveal himself to us such that we can know things for certain, and that's what we're saying to you. You're the one that has granted that you can have no certainty. We can have certainty. So when we tell this to you, we're not telling it to you on our own authority. We're saying this is what God has revealed to us.
Well, I can't have that certainty because I lack the mental faculties to be certain.
Do you know that you can't have that certainty?
See, we're getting back to this game again.
It's not a game. We won't allow you to keep borrowing capital.
Do you know that you can be certain that it is in fact the Christian God that produced these things?
Yes.
You cannot know that.
Are you certain that we can't know that, sir?
Well, if you're certain that I can't know, then by all means, you must be certain that you can't know either.
No, wrong. We're not operating in the same worldview. We're pointing out your worldview. Right now, you got two stages. Sye and I are standing on one stage. Underneath us is the revelation of the all-powerful God. You're standing on a stage as well. And you're supposed to be standing on your atheism, but you keep creeping back over and standing onto our stage to take things that make sense in our worldview.
Well, I think the most I may have grabbed from would be the deistic perspective, and I would most
we're not arguing
say
from
that
the deistic perspective,
I am
though.
An deist as well, but...
But we're not arguing, you understand, we're not arguing from a deistic perspective.
I understand,
we're arguing
the Christian theistic perspective.
That Jesus is God, and that he made you, and that right now you're suppressing the truth about him. And that's our position.
Well,
so that's what you have to argue with.
I actually had the same conversation with a Muslim who you believe in the same God, although you may disagree, but they believe that you believe in the same God. And
if you'd like to convert to Islam, I'd be happy to refute.
We'll refute that too. Because you see, watch this. Can I say this? I'll jump in here. Just one thing I want to say about the Muslim thing, because this is so important because you keep coming back to it. Islam kind of does the same thing that you're doing, but in a different way. And I don't mean this offensive.
Well,
watch this. Islam has borrowed from the Christian worldview and then distorted its message. So it takes parts and pieces of the Christian worldview, then it distorts the message.
Well,
Christianity Christianity is the fulfillment of all of those things. And
but
Jesus actually
the Jews
said
don't believe that those prophecies had come.
Well,
to
actually,
Andre,
well, actually,
they could say that, and we'd be happy to refute them. But we're talking with an atheist now.
Yeah,
yes,
and also,
what we're saying
is that you're doing sort of the same thing that Islam does, but in a different kind of way. Mm-hmm. In that you're borrowing what only makes sense in the Christian worldview, then you're distorting reality and the message itself, because you're borrowing from Christianity, then distorting the message by saying there is no God, there is no God. Islam does kind of the same thing, borrows from Christianity, then distorts its message.
Then what do we call pre-Christian societies which had developed systems of morality, systems of law, had functioning
those are
societies.
Image bearers of God who cannot help but reflecting God's image. They're going to act like image bearers of God. It's inescapable.
I do need to ask before I continue with my next point here, but do you believe that the earth is older than 6,000 years?
Why would that be relevant to this discussion?
Because the point I'm going to make here is there is obviously some difference here, but I'm going to go with 100,000 years because this is the one that's most it's an easy number to work with. So we have human beings existing on Earth for 100,000 years, and during that time, ignorant of what's going on around them. Where do the earthquakes come from? Why does it rain? Where does the lightning come from? Frightened, dying of diseases that they have no concept or basis to understand. And then in the last 2,000 years, God decides, after 98,000 years of ubiquitous suffering, an awful, awful suffering and war and death, 2,000 years, decides, now let's do something about it.
Yeah, and this is Dan Barker's argument. This is argument.
It's a straw man.
Yeah,
I disagree with the timeline, it's irrelevant.
Yes.
Let's say God did it that way. So what?
You're talking about why does it matter that people have war? Why does it matter that people die? Why does it matter that one tribe cut the throats of another tribe? You're assuming human value and dignity, and I'm showing you, once again, you've borrowed from God. You're assuming that it matters that humans kill one another.
Well, no. I'm not borrowing from God. I'm attempting to represent your worldview here within this context. works. God reveals himself through Christ in the last 2,000 years while allowing people to suffer without any
knowledge. It's actually more than the revelation of God goes farther back than 2,000 years.
Of course, it goes back about 4,800 years, I believe.
Well, the Old Testament is completely about the Messiah before he comes, so it's wrong to say just in 2,000 years. The revelation of God started long before
that.
Not
all of it. Some of it is plagiarized. However,
and watch this. First of all, I reject that claim. Second of all, it doesn't make a difference if it was. Mm-hmm. Remember, we're stardust. Plagiarism is okay with stardust. There's no standards or oughts for stardust. Remember that.
I don't want to keep Andre here too long, but one thing is very interesting.
I'm enjoying the discussion.
In an evolutionary world, you right?
I do.
Okay, now, so you would say that our thoughts are the byproduct of the chemical reactions in our evolved brains, correct?
Neuroscience does prove this, yes.
Okay, so now if I took a bottle of Mountain Dew and a bottle of Dr. Pepper, this is Doug Wilson's experiment, and I shook them and I opened them, they start to fizz. That would also be the byproduct of a chemical reaction. Do you not see the absurdity of calling one of those fizzes true and one of those fizzes false? How do you get truth from evolution?
Perhaps I don't understand the question. Are you asking how I obtain?
Our thoughts are the byproduct of chemical reactions.
Well, they
are. How does that codify for
because
truth?
We can, if you, I'm not sure if you're familiar with functional magnetic resonance imaging. It's an fMRI. They can neuroscientists through imaging the brain can actually measure about 700 milliseconds in advance of a decision being made that it's going to occur. So if they ask you to, if the decision is to lift your right arm, they can see that about 700 milliseconds in advance of you actually.
Let me clarify.
Yeah, you're missing the point.
Let me clarify. What is truth?
Qual es veritas? Are you pulling the Pontius Pilate line on me? What is truth is a subjective. I don't have any mechanism by or faculties by which I can make certainty claims.
Are you saying it's objectively true that truth is subjective?
See, this is this game again.
No. Andre, here's the thing. Can I say this to you? I say this with humility. I'm gonna say this with humility to you, but I want you to hear it. You keep saying it's a game, but it's not a game. You're making a claim, and Sye is continually asking you to justify it. It's not a game. Because you don't have an answer doesn't mean it's a game.
Well, he's producing a paradox. There is no answer to
No, he's
paradox.
Showing you the refutation
the
of your own worldview. It's a paradox in your worldview.
He's asking me if I can say that I can have make any truth claims, if I can claim certainty, and then asking me, after I claim that I cannot claim certainty, if that is certain, this is a paradox.
You realize it's a paradox in your worldview, not in ours.
It's not a paradox. It's a self-refutation.
That's what I mean. It's a refutation of your own position, not in our worldview. We don't make those kind of claims.
Except there is a claim that there is a God without any concrete evidence that the God exists.
Okay, once again,
I would say that the very concept of evidence presupposes God.
Yes.
Because evidence presupposes truth.
Well, I mean, how does that not presuppose
Christian? It presupposes knowledge. It presupposes logic, none of which can be made sense of without God.
Well, how does this not presuppose Krishna or Brahman? Which
because they don't exist. And if you would like to argue for them, I'd be happy to engage.
Well, I won't argue for the existence of Krishna.
Good.
Or,
right. So, okay, let's stick with Christianity then. That's what we're talking about.
But what I'm saying is that they can make a Hindu can make a perfectly coherent argument for the existence of their deity.
Well, let me explain that to you then. Because the thing is, you keep leveling these claims. Okay. A Hindu says all is one.
Yes.
It says that I am you and you are me and we are one together. We are all God. And they said that you have to do meditation, you have to do all these things so that you will be enlightened and go to nirvana.
Well, depending on the particular sect.
Well, here's the problem with Hinduism. If all is one, I'm already in nirvana. It's an absurd view. Now, I'd be happy to debate a Hindu and talk to him about that. But if all is one and I have to do something to get to nirvana, mm-hmm. it refutes itself. And I'd be happy to do that with anybody who comes onto this show professing another worldview.
Well,
but when you throw these things out,
look,
I can engage them, but I'm interested in talking to you because I'm concerned about your soul. I'm not concerned about argumentation.
Of course. And, you know, that's one thing I respect about the two of you while engaging me in this discussion is you do at least acknowledge that as part of your worldview, you have to worry about the well-being of other people's souls. This is something that gets missed in discussion often, and when it's difficult for me to find a Christian who can stand by the conviction of their belief and actually attempt to save people.
Yeah, and we mean that
so
too,
often.
Andre. We care for you deeply.
But keep in mind, we can't save people. We're just speaking the truth in love, and hopefully that God saves you.
Yeah. Of course, and I understand, and I respect your willingness to discuss this with me. But I mean, for me, the idea that I would be put in a situation where I could doubt the existence of a creator because of a lack of sufficient empirical evidence, and then be punished for that, it just seems incredibly wicked.
Well, the thing
to
is,
me.
We deny that, of course. We say that you have sufficient evidence, but you suppress the truth and unrighteousness.
Like, the very fact that you bring up empirical evidence assumes things that do not comport with your atheism? Because empirical evidence...
How do you know that I do, in fact, have truth that I'm denying? Is there any way for you to know what I am thinking?
Yeah, well, I can tell you right now what God says about you with certainty. And watch this. You're evidencing what God says about you. For example, you talk about empirical evidence. Empirical evidence assumes that induction holds, that the future would be like the past. You would have to have induction, the principle of induction, and the uniformity in nature, the future being like the past, to have empirical evidence mean anything.
Well, this would
but
have
watch
to
this.
Be something which
but
is
watch
theoretical.
This. No, 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 no. But watch this, because you appeal to it right now. You haven't thought for even 1 second this whole 2 hours you've been here. You haven't thought you're going to float away out of your chair to the ceiling. How come you've made that assumption?
Because my experience tells me otherwise.
Right, but you can't justify an appeal to the future being like the past because you don't believe in a sovereign God, the sovereign God who carries the universe along. You are living by blind faith. And then...
Except
and then,
over the course of the 24 years that I've been alive, the future has consistently
but
been
the past.
The problem with that,
the past
will be like the past because it has been like the past is circular.
It's viciously circular.
Well, I'm not disagreeing with that. I'm just saying
then you can't make an appeal against
God.
Then
what alternative position could I take other than
Christ?
Christ.
Turn from sin to God and trust in Him, Andre, for forgiveness and salvation. You're making appeals. You look like a Christian right now. You're appealing to uniformity in nature, laws of logic,
moral
laws. I
don't know
if
that's a compliment.
You're
a
sweet
guy.
No, it's in sense a compliment. I'm showing you that you're made in the image of God, and you're displaying it all over your life right now. And the reason that you're in the position you're in is because, just like us before Christ, you're sin, and you need to turn from that to Christ for forgiveness.
Well, see, this is the thing is, I don't understand, and perhaps if you want to elaborate on this, because I'm going with an argument of my ignorance here. I do not understand why a loving God would create us as an imperfect being and then command us to be perfect. Create us sick and then essentially command us to be well.
That's not true, though.
This is we are created flaws and then also created a being.
Well, let me help you, because you're arguing it's a straw man. God didn't create us sick. God created, the Bible says in Ecclesiastes, He created man upright, but He sought out many devices. That ultimately, as image bearers of God, we've fallen and rebelled against our Creator. Why create us
in such a way that we could fall?
But here's the question, though. The fact that you don't understand it does not deny the possibility of it.
Well, of course not. I would never deny that. But
right, so the thing is, why did God do it? For His glory.
Well,
God does stuff the way that He wants to do it for His glory, because He is worthy.
Does this not seem a little bit... pompous, though.
You can't.
Why do
not
question
God?
God is
worthy. Ready?
Job. And when God answered, and do you know what Job did? Job put his hand in front of his mouth. He said, "I spoke too soon. I'm not going to question God."
Without God, we can't make sense of anything. And one of the things
I'll tell you one thing. I want to let you talk to this. You said, "Isn't that pompous?" But remember, you're stardust. Pompous is fine.
Okay, maybe pompous is fine.
So the claim you made is meaningless. It's irrelevant, isn't it? Do you see where atheism has brought you?
To me, it does have meaning.
You're just a bag of protoplasm.
Yes,
you're not in charge of other bags of protoplasm.
For that meaning is as weak as your justification for meaning being provided by a deity.
Child molestation has meaning to child molesters. Doesn't make it right.
Right.
Of course, I do. I would agree with you.
So, your subjective feelings about what
is
right or wrong
is
irrelevant.
So heavily critical of Cardinal Ratzinger. One of the
we're not Roman Catholic, so you're in good company.
I read everything in your criticism of him. However,
I was raised Roman Catholic.
Our worldview makes sense of that. Yours doesn't.
Right, I can make sense of Cardinal Ratzinger doing something wrong if it's true that he did. I don't know anything about it, but I can make sense of that. So can Sye. Mm-hmm. Because we say that's a violation of God's own law and character. But you're making a moral complaint against him. But you're stardust, and so is he.
Well, see, this is the thing is we're trying. I already acknowledged my assumptions on the physical world and
commitments.
My moral position does mean something to me, but I wouldn't call it a faith commitment because I have no choice. I don't have an alternative.
Well, the thing is, you have no choice.
Can you choose? And I understand, yes, there's the choice, but do you have, as an individual, as a human being, do you have the capacity to murder somebody for no reason?
I don't understand how it's relevant.
It is relevant because I don't have that capacity. I cannot bring myself to kill another person.
I'll ask you this way then. Okay, I'm just asking you one question. Mm-hmm. Do you eat meat?
I do eat meat.
Do you eat salads?
I do eat salads.
Meat and salads are other products of blind and purposeless forces acting on matter through this evolutionary trail that got us to this point. You eat meat and salads, but how come you don't want to eat and kill other people? How come? Why have you made that arbitrary distinction between the hamburger and the spinach and this person over here? Why do you not want to eat and harm them, but you will eat and harm these other products of evolution?
Well, because evolutionarily, it's beneficial for our species.
Who cares about beneficial? Stardust. Why does Stardust want to promote the...
If we look at any species on Earth, human beings seem to be the only ones that willfully kill each other en masse.
And there's nothing wrong with that. They're stardust.
But then how do we acknowledge... How then...
Your assumption here is that human beings have value and dignity.
Yes, we do have value and dignity.
Okay, now ready. Justify it. You're an atheist. Justify the value and dignity that you are giving to human beings.
I can't justify that outside of the assumption that human beings have to cooperate with each other in order to survive.
But watch this. But one doesn't lead to the other. I asked you to justify the claim that human beings have value and dignity.
You can't get an instrument, and I have acknowledged that. But right. I have also acknowledged that I work with assumptions because I have no choice in the matter.
Well, here's a huge problem with your view, and I'll explain it. There are people on this earth who, according to your view, have evolved to believe that the planet is the most important. And there are other people who have evolved to believe that humans are the most important. Now, the question is, how do you know who's right? Because the people who have evolved to believe that the planet is most important says that humans are maggots on the planet and they should all be killed.
I've not met any non-theist who believes that.
No, but they're out there.
How do you know which is right? There are plenty of people out there who take extreme views. We both know this.
Well, how do you know which is right? That's my question.
How do you know it's extreme? Why isn't yours extreme? Why are you arbitrarily saying yours isn't extreme, but theirs is?
Okay, well, then I'll say it's different.
You've got two value systems that have evolved. Ready? One is... Now, hurt people, and one is love them. Why have you picked one over the other?
The environmentalists I've met, and I can't speak for everybody, the environmentalists that I have met value the protection of our planet in order to preserve it for future generations of human beings.
Let me get underneath that.
Okay,
ready?
But the problem is there are people who say that humans should leave this planet, humans should be killed for the survival of the planet.
Yes.
And my question is, how do you determine who's right, the people who say the planet is the most important people who say humans on the planet are most important? Which one is right, and how do you determine that?
If we're basing our values on the advancement of the human condition, then an individual who believes that we should be eradicated...
It's begging the question, though.
I beg your pardon?
It's begging the question.
Mm-hmm.
You're assuming what's to be proven in the proof. You're assuming that human value is the right one. Why isn't Earth value the right one?
Well, I'm saying if we're basing our values on the
advancement of the human condition, which one should you base it on? Which one is the proper one to base it on?
I can't make that claim, but obviously...
That's the problem.
So now you have no basis whatsoever for what is right, what is true, what is beautiful, what is lovely, because you say, I don't really know.
Well, what I'm saying is that we have obviously come to a position as a species where cooperation is not only key but valued by the species.
You're assuming there that stardust should flourish and should be okay. Why?
Why is it not the view that the Earth is the most important? Why isn't that the right view?
And to respond to that, we're not simply stardust. We are made out of elements which were forged in stars.
Made by whom?
We are composed of elements which were... This guy's good.
Yeah.
We are composed of elements which were forged in stars. However, we are much more complex than just a pile of stardust.
My point is that you have to go beyond. This is what's in front of us. This matter, this material, this bag, this thing.
This is what I'm able to perceive.
Right. And I'm saying, but you're giving more value and dignity to it than stardust. You got to justify that. You can't just make that assumption. And with your atheism, I'm saying you can't. Now, if you would just notice.
Of course not.
If you have to notice for a second, Andre, that the whole time you've been here, you've been reasoning like a Christian. As soon as it's pointed out to you that you're imaging God and you're denying your atheism, you keep going back to
I don't think these positions come from God. I think that you, with or without God, are a good person, and I can respect that.
What is good without God?
It's good, yeah.
Well, I'm going to go with my perception on morality. I can't speak for everybody.
So does
obviously,
a child molester. That's the problem.
Well, a child molester could very well be psychologically or psychiatrically flawed.
As far as you know, they could be doing the right thing.
Flawed? Where are you getting the standard of flawed versus non-flawed? You're acting like there's an objective standard out there people have to hold to versus flawed and non-flawed, logical and illogical. And what I'm saying is that you are protoplasm.
I would like to get back to a point which I've been trying to make it, but we've been getting sidetracked. Not that that's anybody's fault. I'm engaging in the discussion just as much as any other party here.
Okay.
My position on morality is that we base our moral decisions on on human values. And these values come from, of course, advancing the condition of human beings. Now, if we look at we choose not to kill people, we choose not to steal. I mean, these things are based on the fact that based on the fact that we wish to preserve the civil society that we live in. When a Christian claims, or really any religious person, if they were, well, let's look at a fanatic. Let's say we've got Anders Breivik, someone who's just off a little bit, who blows up a Norwegian government building. And this is the man who wrote the 1,500-page manifesto railing against the Islamization of Europe. He believed he was doing God's work. Now, he viewed that massacre as a good thing because he, the same as anyone else, values the advancement of the human condition, but he sees the ultimate advancement of that condition as getting people into paradise.
The
problem
is
getting people
to
heaven,
two of us, we're the only ones that can say that that was wrong. You can't. You can say he evolved differently.
Why can I not say it? No. That's not how evolution works.
Because you're an atheist. Don't forget to look at your feet.
That's not how evolution works.
Did he not evolve to formulate his opinion? Did he not also evolve?
Individuals don't evolve differently. A population evolves over an incredible length of time with minor variations from generation to generation.
Why is his the aberration? I mean, why is his the one that's not doing it right?
That's been asked of you several times.
How do you know that he's not just a super being that's evolved to do it the right way?
Yeah, that's been asked of you several times, and maybe we're not making it clear to you or communicating, but that's the point, is that you're having one value rise up over blind and purposeless evolution and another one, and you keep highlighting one over the other, but it's arbitrary. Why are you picking one over the other? You're an atheist.
Why am I picking? So you're asking why I'm picking?
Why are you mad at him for blowing people up?
Yeah, why survival over destruction?
Why would you be mad at him for blowing people up? Let's ask that question.
Yeah, this should be obvious to you. We're in the image of God. God is love. Love does no harm to its neighbor. Mm-hmm. God commands us not to murder. We have certainty on that, but you're an atheist.
Is not treating somebody with kindness without
kindness? Why are you assuming human value and dignity and kindness? Man, you are imaging God all over your life. You're talking
about
kindness.
Not only that, why is it not kind to kill people?
Would you perceive it as kind if someone
no,
tried to kill you?
No, but we have a standard. That's the problem.
We have a standard that's based on human cooperation, and
no, but
human
so
beings
did that
generally
guy.
Don't
he
like
had a standard
being murdered
based on his individuality. Yeah. Why is his wrong?
I'm acknowledging your standard you make. It's social cooperation.
Yes.
And I'm pointing out to you that, okay, I'll stand on social cooperation for a second. Society says we should work towards human flourishing. But let's say I get another society over here that rises up over time and overwhelms your society in size, and I say destruction of humanity is the norm. It's the ought.
Yes.
You have no argument.
Society wouldn't survive very long.
But watch this. I'm not talking about what it would do. I'm saying that your argument is that this is how the oughts come and the values come. And I'm saying I could get a society over here that says, no, it's destruction of humanity. Well, and what I'm saying is you have no argument against that. I'm using your standard.
We can see very clearly, though, that individuals in societies which seek ultimate destruction of humanity, or which are operate in contrast to human cooperation, do not survive.
So what?
They don't survive.
So?
Is human survival the right goal?
Isn't that the goal for every species?
Well, that's not – I'm asking if that's
the
proper
question being
goal.
Asked
is human survival the proper goal?
How could I determine that?
Well, because I'll give you a few options. Is justice the proper goal? Is beauty the proper goal? Or is survival the proper goal? Is survival of the individual the proper goal? Or survival of the group the proper goal? Which is the proper goal, and how do you determine which is the proper goal?
Well, see, I wouldn't argue that there's one right way to achieve something which is good.
That's exactly
because
what you are.
We have a plurality of ideals in our society, which I think is very valuable. We have to discuss it, and we have to achieve decisions based on rationalization.
So society
which I think
gets
is a very
to determine that the flourishing
thing
of the society
However,
is the proper goal? That's begging the question. Why can't the individual determine that the survival of the individual is the proper goal? Why can't power be the proper goal and the powerful people of the world survive and they eat the weak? Mm. Why can't that be the proper goal?
Well, one, because we know that diseases propagate when we eat each other and they wouldn't
survive.
So they
would sanitize it. They have means of doing
that. Yeah, we can
that.
Cook it well.
Well, no, I'm not talking about cooking it. I'm talking about the prions which exist, prions which can
I mean, I mean, I, my point is the answer is here. Ready? So what? So what? We're standing on atheism now. There is no God, no purpose, no good, no evil, blind, pitiless indifference. We evolved from fish to philosophers. Here's my answer to what you said.
Well, you're
so
asking
what?
Me to prove an unprovable.
For you, it's unprovable.
Well,
what
it, it's also
unprovable.
Well, but your proof is that there has to be some sort of divine agency to create this.
Well, let me ask you a question.
But there's
you brought
no
up a very good point. You say that something's
agent.
Unprovable. Proof presupposes truth. You can't prove something that's not true. And the thing is, you've abandoned your position on truth. You said, I can't know what's true.
No, I
so
have,
the thing is, when you demand proof, you're already abandoning your world.
I have abandoned the position on being able to make absolutes based on the fact that I have to assume that my senses are giving me accurate information.
Then how can anybody
prove anything? Within the confines of a reality which is sensory, there can be truth claims. And we're dealing within the assumption now. Keep in mind we are dealing within the assumption.
Within the assumption that you're
infallible. Within the assumption 2 plus 2 equals 4. 2 plus 2 can never equal anything other than 4.
Why not?
Because within the assumption, my observation tells me that this is the case.
So you're saying that your assumptions assume that equals that, and you say it can never not be the case because you're assuming that.
I have no choice other than to assume information is accurate.
How do you know that you have no choice?
Because the choice hasn't presented itself. If there were a choice,
so then you don't know that you have no choice. You're just unaware of any other choice.
That could very well be the possibility.
So 2 plus 2 doesn't necessarily equal 4.
Within the assumption, it does.
Yeah, right. But that's begging
the
question.
But see, we're getting this is something which is very silly to discuss, though, because I don't have a choice as to whether. And yes, I realize we just established that there's no choice. But I am having this discussion with you right now. Perceivably, I cannot choose to not perceive having this discussion.
Amen. Now, watch this. Can I say this to you, Andre? Certainly. This is the point: is that our contention is that God is so very imminent, so very active that it's inescapable. You're right. You cannot live in this world apart from how He's made it and how He's made you.
Which is why I live with the assumptions that I live in this world.
Of course you do, because you're an image bearer of God.
Well, because what other option do I have?
You don't have any other option. Precisely. Because you're an image bearer of God. But the amazing thing is that you violate what is so obvious to you at every turn of your life with your profession of faith in atheism.
How is it obvious?
It's very obvious because you make all these truth claims, all these human value and dignity claims, appeals to uniformity in nature.
Within an assumption that the natural laws are valid.
Of course, because that's the world you live in.
Yes.
But child molester assumes that child molesting is, gives him pleasure and he wants to do that.
But your atheism,
apart from an absolute standard, you can't say what he did is wrong. Now, you can start with any arbitrary standard.
Well, again, I'll go back to the statement, though. If you need religion to tell you not to molest a child, it's not religion you lack.
Okay,
it's
why
empathy.
Should we not molest children?
Because I can't believe I actually have to answer this question.
Yes, you do, actually.
With your atheism,
if you need religion to tell us why it's wrong, I want you to tell me why it's absolutely morally wrong to molest children.
With your atheism. You're an atheist.
Would you prefer a world in which children are brought up in...
What I would prefer is not an answer to how you justify it. How do you justify child molestation being absolutely morally wrong according to atheism?
Because it's contrary to the general well-being of humans.
What's wrong with that?
It's counterintuitive to human cooperation.
So what? Why is that wrong?
We're using your atheism. We don't believe this, Andre.
Well, yes, but we're going outside of the assumption again. We have granted that I live within a world in which I have to assume
that
this is what I perceive.
Right, but you don't know that that's a correct assumption.
Well, of course I don't.
You can't say that child molestation is wrong.
I can't say that it's a correct assumption, but the fact is the assumption is there.
Right.
I don't have a choice but to make that assumption. It's not arbitrary because I don't have a choice in the matter.
Oh, so it's not arbitrary, so it's absolute now?
My assumption?
Yes.
My personal assumption... I'm going to say is an absolute as far as my observation allows me to.
Okay, how do you know that you have no other option?
There's absolutely no way that I could respond to that question and not be wrong.
That's right, and that's the problem, sir, and that's why
but
I urge you to
repent. How do you know that you have no other option?
By and through revelation from God. That's the only way we can know anything.
Well, I mean, again, back to I could say by and through revelation from Odin.
You can, but then what you have to do to defend your view is give up your view. And I'll be happy to discuss, if you want to become an Odinite and come onto the show, I'll discuss that.
Odinite, is that the right word? Yeah. That sounds like it's the right word.
You've done it several times. We're not just giving you a reversible authority claim. Where we're throwing it out and saying
well, you're
you can reverse
an authority
it.
Claim that's based on one particular deity.
Right, and what I'm saying
only
is
one that
about
exists.
The only one
that
but where he doesn't just make that claim, he provides evidence, and the evidence right now is the person the person sitting in front of me right now is denying the God of this revelation, but all the while living in cooperation with the worldview he's presented.
Mithraic followers, Zoroastrians, believe that their God is the only one that exists and believe that your worldview is flawed and that you are stealing
from them. I would say that they don't, that they're also suppressing the truth and unrighteousness. And if you want to argue from their position,
How can you be certain that they are suppressing the truth? How is it that you have the mental faculties to know what
certain.
They
That's
are
how we
thinking.
Know. I'm certain the same way they are, that there's only one God.
Well, yes, but
the truth. And if you want to argue for
someone
one of
with
them,
severe schizophrenia may be certain
you.
That they're Napoleon Bonaparte and say that God told them that they are, in fact, Napoleon Bonaparte, but that doesn't necessarily make it true.
Exactly, and I would be happy to engage them.
So then you are acknowledging then what you're saying could very well be false.
No.
How does that not acknowledge it?
How does it not acknowledge? Because God has revealed truth such that we can know it for certain.
Yes, and so is Mithra and Astaroth and Tammuz and Osiris. And they, all of these different religious groups believe that their gods have revealed
truth. Is that true, sir?
Then how is it that you know?
Sir, is it true that all of these other religions do that?
Is it true that your religion does that?
Well, see, that's the thing. I mean, if we're going to have a discussion,
you gotta
answer
the question.
You answer, you ask a question, I answer.
Yeah, but,
is it
but
true that
you're
the other worldviews do that?
You're asking me silly questions, because I could ask the same question of you,
you
and
could,
we'll still
and
not
I'd be
get
happy
anywhere.
To answer it if you answer the question. Is it true that these other worldviews do that?
Yeah, but then, see, if I answer that question, you're going to challenge me over my admission that I can't have certainty. I don't see any
right,
point
exactly.
in answering
right,
that
right,
question.
Right, right, that's the point.
Yes, and then how is it
been reduced to absurdity?
Then if you are certain that the other worldviews are wrong, let's go back. If you are certain that your worldview is correct, how can you possibly guarantee that certainty? How can you make that statement of certainty?
I don't need to guarantee it. God guarantees it.
God guarantees it. Well, so do the other gods.
Well, is that true that the other gods do that?
Is it true that your god does it?
Yes, it is.
And in what evidence do you have that supports your claim over the claim that Osiris does it?
The evidence of our claim.
I beg your pardon?
The very concept of evidence, because evidence presupposes
which,
truth,
which, could be,
which cannot be made sense
which
of without
God. Could very well
God.
Be said of Brahma, which
is
rational.
Is it true that could be said of Brahman?
Is it true? Well, in the same way that it's true that it could be said about God.
So you're saying it is true?
No. In right, the same way that it could
this,
be
but
said
but I
want to
challenge. I
want to
challenge
God.
Something here real fast. Mithras and Osiris and all these different other gods you're bringing up. Could you give me the quotation where they make the claim that they are the only God, none before, none after, the self-existent God, and that all of the universe is dependent upon them? Give me the reference.
You want an exact quotation. Well,
because here's the thing. The uniqueness
I'm
of the biblical—
I'm not a theologian.
Right, right, but you made the claim.
But what I can tell you is that Mithra, if we go back to Osiris, which is this is where most of the post-Jewish plagiarism of Egyptian religion comes from. The Osiris
well,
was called
that,
the way,
that's a claim.
The light,
that, that's
the truth,
a claim. That's only a claim. Watch this. We got to go. They're calling us out of here right now. But I want to say this, Andre. You've made a claim that is just not true.
Well, I mean, even the Ten Commandments
the biblical,
are derived
one
from
second,
the Egyptian Book of the Dead.
No. The one second. The claim of Scripture is that it's a self-existent, non-dependent, eternal God.
And highly contradictory.
Hold on now. Now, hold on. Contradictions don't matter. You're stardust. They don't matter. You once again image God.
But then if you're, once if you're
again,
going to claim that
now,
the document is infallible.
Andre, you got to let me finish my statement.
Go ahead.
You made a false claim about these other religions trying to compare it to the God of the Bible. That's false. It is patently false. Mm-hmm. Historically speaking, the revelation of God in Scripture is entirely unique of a non-dependent, self-existent, eternal, personal God. Those other religions don't even come close. So that was a false claim.
And flooded
and
with
then,
contradictions.
And then when you say contradictions, I wanted to show you real fast. Look at your feet. You just imaged God again because your atheism says that you're stardust, and yet you're complaining about contradictions. There are no universal invariant laws of logic that any of us have to hold to.
Okay.
Well, I'll say one last thing. This is my last thing. My last thing I want to say is that your brain gas isn't in charge of anybody else. And so you complaining about contradictions of thought processes, your brain gas as a bag of stardust in this purposeless universe isn't in charge of anybody, Andre.
But if – okay, well then fine. Well, I will accept the admission that maybe contradictions don't matter to
okay,
me.
Okay, good. We got to go.
I disagree.
We got to go.
All right,
thanks
a lot, guys.
Thanks,
I really appreciate
thanks,
it. Sorry. And hope to talk to you again soon.
Okay, Sye. Bye-bye.
Yeah, bye-bye.
Only, but I have to say that if we're going to – the contradictions must matter to you then if you hold the claim that the physical reality is something that you can claim certainty about.
They do. Contradictions are important for me to work through, but not for you. Not for you. No, you can't make that claim, though, because you're assuming –